code of the network or anyone affiliated. There will be mature and possibly immature content. Viewer discretion is strongly advised. As a matter of fact, I probably wouldn't listen at all. It's very poorly produced. Take me to your leader.
Take me to your leader.
Listener. And here is your host, the Wolfman, Mike.
This is where the real freaks hang out, all right, yeah.
Right, we're on the air. We're back. I'm just waking up and I'm nursing a beer and hope everyone else is not hungover like me. That was a late night. Okay. And shout out to Mark Hanapepe and I can't pronounce, what is this? Mrs. a Foxgiven. Something like that. In the Spreaker chat room. All right. Everybody go to the Spreaker chat room. Go to Spreaker.com. Find Monster Castle Paranormal. Click on it. Click on the show that says live. And if you're online, you just go to comments down below and you are in the chat room. So how's it going today, Darren?
It's going pretty good. Just woke up.
You just woke up? Are you hungover too?
I'm not hungover.
You missed church, didn't you?
I'm a little groggy.
Groggy, yeah.
I didn't have a chance to get any coffee yet here.
Okay, that's Rachel in the chat room. That's wild. Okay. Today, this afternoon, we're going to cover some wide variety of topics. And I don't know if you have any news, Darren?
No.
Yeah, I didn't get any news ready, but we could just bring the guest on right now. And it's Joseph Moore. Are you there, Joe?
I am. Hello, everyone. How are you guys? How are you doing, Mike? Darren?
Excellent. Yeah.
Thanks for coming back.
I was just thinking.
Thank you for having me back on.
I'm thinking instead of covering the news, maybe we could just discuss what's going on down in Syria for a minute again. Have you guys heard anything new developments?
I just saw on CNN, I have it, my TV muted in the living room, our TV, something else right now. But apparently, I guess ISIS, they believe it to be ISIS. You know how it is, a lot of disgruntled people claim to be with ISIS or they just take credit for it. But anyway, lone wolf or inspired attacks, as they call it. I guess on some United States military base, I think it said, I forgot where it was. I'm not sure if it was Egypt or somewhere in the Middle East, but the military repelled the attack. But it's not like an old-fashioned troops are on the way, they're advancing onto your citadel. And it's just, you know, a lot of these people, they're just inspired. I don't see it as a – I'm trying to say this in such a way where it doesn't sound like I'm mitigating the situation. I don't see it the same as the old-fashioned way, like I said, of armies attacking you. It is terrible what happened. But keeping things in perspective, when they're inspired, someone could just...
Hello? It's okay, you can tell us.
I don't know what happened there. Did you drop?
Uh-oh.
United States.
Yeah.
And you know how, if anybody who's well aware of the United States, we're, with all due respect, and nothing against my fellow Americans, but we're pretty violent. Something like 26 to 30,000 people die each year of gun-related deaths. Now, on average, each year. And I can't remember for sure the statistics that, like, some of it's accidental, but most of it is violence. That's every year. But where's about that? And of course, you know, I'm not going to get too political here about gun control or whatever. But that, you know, when a few people are killed by someone who's Muslim and who's a radical, regardless of what political affiliation, just for the fact that they're Muslim and you know, of course, kill somebody, you should never do that. But they'll focus on, like, a few, you know, people who are killed by some radical person who's of Muslim faith, but then they don't pay attention to Americans, we killing ourselves on something between 20 to close to 30,000 people each year in the United States via handguns. You know, in the state of, I'm calling from Lincoln, Nebraska. In Nebraska, there's a lot of towns that are not even that size.
Yeah, and I don't know, do you guys carry guns?
I do not, but I do believe in self-defense, but I do not have a gun.
What about you, Darren? Do you carry a gun?
I do not carry a gun. Well, no. I don't carry a gun. I have guns. Someone comes into my house.
Oh, right on.
I have all my.
What about yourself, Mike?
In Canada here, I cannot divulge that information out because we have too much regulations against that for me to bother saying even an answer to that.
I can tell you this much: had I been carrying a gun once in my life, I would have used it. And I'm glad I didn't. So that's why I don't carry. Well, yeah. You know what I mean?
You know, I'm a Democrat. I am a socialist. I'm not a liberal. I'm further to the left than that. But a lot of people, especially in the United States, they make the assumption that if you're a liberal or to the left like I am, that we're just all hippies and we're pacifists and yada yada. I was racist, but
He dropped again. Right on. We got a shout out to Dennis and Joe in the speaker chat room. And shout out
Angry
to KTLK Network, the fringe.fm, which we are on right now. Yeah. And, okay, yeah, about guns in Canada. Yeah, it's really regulated here. It's crazy. So they make it pretty hard.
Can I ask you about how many deaths from guns-related incidents do you know each year?
Oh, my God. Well, if you're looking at Toronto, it's like almost every day. You know, but the rest of Canada, like except for the big cities, you don't really hear much about it.
Chicago or New York City.
It's usually some other weapon that people have. Like we had a standoff just down the street here last week, and there was an armed standoff, and they actually had to evacuate this low rental area and evacuate everyone else out, and they brought someone out on a stretcher. I haven't heard anything else since what happened there. If it was gun-related or if it was a stabbing, I don't know.
But I mean, it doesn't sound like it happens that often nationwide.
Well, it's strange, though. I never saw anything about it in the news. The only thing I know is because people in my neighborhood told me that the place was evacuated and there was some kind of armed standoff. And I saw a news vehicle there, but I still haven't, like CTV News was there. But I still haven't heard anything about it on the news.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, you know, let's be honest about it. Had the person been Muslim, had the person been, you know, certain ethnicity, I'm sure you would have heard something about it. Let's just be real about this. You know, it seems like people don't, like I said a few minutes ago in the United States, and when people kill each other every day, whether it's black on black, white on white, or, you know, when it's interracial, as in, you know, a black person kills a white person or vice versa, then it's a big topic. But still, the biggest topic when it comes down to murder, regardless of, you know, it's political or just everyday, when the person is a Muslim, then it's a big situation. That's the only thing that they focus on. So that may have been the situation because it's considered an everyday thing. So what's the big deal? You know, few people who die at the hands of some, you know, a Muslim of whatever stripe, then it's automatically terrorism.
Oh, yeah, and, you know, for sure.
I'm
yeah.
sorry, but that's what I've noticed here in the United States. Like, there are certain things I read about or hear about, you know, online, like several people are killed by some, and it's like more people are killed, you know, it could be some kind of family situation or somebody just flipped out for no political reasons and just killed like six people. And you hear nothing about it. And you know, like CNN, or I don't watch Fox News or read it online. I stay away from right-wing media. But you hear nothing about it because it's they're not Muslim. It's not, you know, it's not dealing with the Middle East. It's just like local news, like, oh, yeah.
It's just boring. Just today, somebody getting shot, you know. This Joe Blow shot this guy over there for some crack, and who cares? He's dead, right?
Right, right. And it's not just the race thing, and just in general. It could be two white guys, white people kill each other, and it's hardly ever covered. But again, as soon as you put in Muslim, oh boy, it's just it's incredible. But anyway, I'm trying not to, you know, I don't want to be negative.
Well, it's not negative. So, it's realist. It's realism.
I meant like, you know, me getting worked up and getting, you know, angry. That's more of what I mean.
Oh, that's okay. You can get worked up here.
That's it.
Yeah, trust me. I can get really...
We have the Russian solution.
I'm a geek and I laugh a lot and stuff, but trust me, I have a temper.
Did you talk about KGB?
And I do not want to display it.
You were not talking about KGB, were you? You were not...
No.
Do not talk about KGB, all right? You cannot talk about KGB or Russia. I am sorry. Well, it's okay. You can bash.
We certainly have KGB somewhere in the White House, don't we?
We have people in White House and also in Black House, too. Black House and the White House. White and black, both houses.
So what are you, Joseph, what are your feelings about what's going on with Syria right now?
Okay, and I had tweeted about this quite a bit. I think it's kind of, you know, expected, to be honest with you. Well, you know, it's no coincidence. It's not like Democrats have not done the similar things, because Bill Clinton, he did that with, you know, as you remember, the situation with the Balkans, former Yugoslavia. We sent in troops and yada yada, things of that nature. Different circumstances, but of course, Obama, former President Obama, he kind of amped up the troops a little bit more after a lot of political outcry of not being, you know, muscular enough. So he kind of, to appease a lot of right wingers, he kind of bumped up the troops levels in, I believe, Iraq a little bit more. Now, in the situation, what happened, basically all what Trump ordered was the bombing of an airfield. And you just look at, whether online or TV, I don't read print. I just read everything online pretty much now, except for novels, you know, science fiction novels. That's the only thing I read in print anymore. But anyway, if you read and watch the media, BBC or CNN or MSNBC, you'll see that it's just basically just an airfield that was bombed.
It looks like the smallest airport in the world.
Assad's chemical weapons, they're still functional. So what the hell? I mean, it has not changed the facts on the ground.
It looks like
he did something, and he wants to be the antithesis to Obama. I mean, we don't want someone, okay, who wants someone in the White House sitting there being rational, thinking things through, but rather you'd rather just act just for the sake of acting. Mind you, six people were killed, but you don't really hear about that or read about it. I think they were all, Syrian, of the Syrian, or excuse me, yeah, the Syrian army, I believe. But yeah, I'm not a pacifist. There are times to go to war, like World War II, for instance. But situations like Fareed Zakaria on CNN, and he also does other things too. But he made a point that basically just making a statement via the military and even other military experts, and I'm not an expert in this. This is outside my realm, but I do have opinions. And more importantly, I'm citing experts who know about it more than I do. And it's like just making a statement, you know, you're bombing an airfield just to show that you mean business. Well, we already made that point when we dropped the atomic bombs on two cities in Japan. We already know actually, people don't realize this, and I encourage the listeners and everyone else to go on to their website and look it up. But plowshares.com. They do a good job of keeping track of where they're for nuclear disarmament throughout the world. But anyway, they do a good job of keeping track of how many nuclear arms are throughout the world. Russia actually has more. They have something like 9,000 to 10,000 nukes. We have just a slightly less, something like we have about.
That's nuts,
about 500
man.
Less than they do.
What do you need all more. That for? It'd be like firecracker day, but the world's blowing up. Like, come on.
Yeah, at that point, it doesn't matter.
No, that's ridiculous. Think about how ridiculous that is. Joseph, I got 2 points
here.
That is ridiculous. To have that many weapons of mass destruction is just ridiculous. Where are you going to use them all? And don't they wear out? What do you do with them when they wear out, when the expiry date goes on this stuff? Is that why they used up all these cruise missiles on probably a dead target? They just wasted about $1 billion, isn't it? Now,
it's closer to 2 million or less than 2 million for each time they use each cruise missile.
Yeah, I thought it was $1.5 million per cruise missile. I think it's about almost $1 billion that they, 59 missiles, I think it's about $1 billion that they wasted on a dead target that was probably already abandoned. That's what I suspect.
Right. And let me emphasize, if I may, guys, remember those figures I was telling about from Plowshares is their name, Plowshares. And, of course, you can get it from United Nations and, of course, the official federal governments. You know, there are various ways you can read about this, and the numbers will fluctuate depending on which source that you read. But generally speaking, it's something like 9,000 to 10,000 nukes that Russia has, and we have just slightly under that.
How many people?
That's just those two nations.
How many?
That's just those two nations.
Okay, let's get a vote here. Let's get a vote here. How many people vote that they think it's a dead target that they hit? Do you think that was there was anyone there, or that was just a setup and an abandoned airport?
I don't think it was an abandoned airport.
I wouldn't be surprised with this administration. That would be something they would do. If you're willing to lie about saying that Obama was not born in the United States and all these alternative facts and everything, you set the standards that we cannot trust you, that you're going to lie about everything. And I get that you don't want to broadcast everything, but when you start just habitually lying to even just about bare facts, I wouldn't be surprised if they did that. But, even if it were a live target, it's in the end, it's still just an airfield. It's not like he took out their manufacturing plant or something like
Hello?
That. You guys remember hearing about Stuxnet a few years ago? You guys know what that is?
Okay, so I was told my math is sketchy. Yeah, so it would be like 59 or 100 million for the missiles, somewhere around there.
Okay. All right, yeah, because it actually one or two of them fell into the sea. It didn't work, and so they had to launch like one or two more to make up for that. Stuxnet was okay. Iran a few years ago, they had centrifuges. That's what you use to separate materials to make nuclear energy. You use it for bombs, or you can use it just for energy. So I'm saying nuclear energy, okay? Whether or not they had Iran had the intention of using it for bombs or not, that's a different story. They had centrifuges, thousands of them. The United States, as it's well reported, anybody can Google this, United States, working with the government of Israel, they had actually hacked into the government of Iran, their defense system, whatever it was, and they hacked and then they tricked the centrifugal machinery to spin out of control, and it broke down, physically broke down their Iran's government's capability of producing nuclear energy. I'm not talking about bombs, just nuclear energy. We did that about 4 or 5 years ago. That is something, we have that capability. It's not officially acknowledged, but, you know, again, you can read about this in several different, you know, it's been around for a few years now. To me, that's a bigger deal, and to me, that's something we could look more into rather than just going out a full-fledged war just for what? And here, real quick, I want to make this point, and this is key. And, of course, Trump was using the subterfuge of seeing babies dying and foaming at the mouth and all this other stuff, these Syrian babies, and we must attack them because of that. A, you have blocked Syrian babies from coming into this country as refugees. B, does it really matter if it's chemical weapons or if it's barrel bombs from Assad, President al-Assad, you know, because that's where most of the people are dying from, are from barrel bombs and just basic bombs. But because...
Who do you think really did that? Do you think he did that? Because, like, Darren, the logic isn't there.
Nope. Maybe they snuck a bomb on one of those planes that was a chemical bomb or something. Maybe they hit a munition on the ground. I can't see him doing that. They've already killed 500,000 people with regular bombs. Why do that? It's a false
flag.
And
I understand, and let me say this real quick. And I get that because, relatively speaking, it's still transitioning from Obama. And let me say this too, because it drives me nuts when people say this. I got to say this real quick. Okay. People keep blaming Obama. He wasn't, you know, he wasn't strong enough. He wasn't, you know, nationalistic enough and da, 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 you know. Okay. Keep in mind, folks, and I remember this wasn't that long ago. He went to Congress to ask for war, you know, for authorization from Congress. They voted against it, just like what in United Kingdom. Basically, they, and I'm talking about troops. Let me clarify, to send troops in to Syria. That's different from air. Now, that's still military action, you know, kind of, you know, just the bombing. It was about sending in troops. The UK Parliament voted against it. If you remember the former Prime Minister, I can't believe I forgot his name. But anyway, the last guy who was Prime Minister, I can't believe I forgot his name. Anyway, he wanted to do the same thing as Obama. They voted for, in the case of the UK Prime Minister, the UK Parliament voted against sending in troops, and so did Congress on our side of the Atlantic, voted against sending in troops. But now all of a sudden they want to. And had President Obama did exactly what Trump did this past week, that is to say, do military strikes without Congress authorization, trust me, the right wingers in this country, United States, they would have been talking about, oh, he's a dictator. He's trying to bypass Congress. But it's okay for Trump to act without congressional authority, without a congressional authorization for war. See, this is the stuff that goes on that drives me nuts that people don't talk about. And they're because the way that in American media, they're even in, like, I'm not even talking about Fox, okay? Just basically, your run-of-the-mill media. Basically, it's almost like they're just being lazy, or they don't know what happened with the history of it, as if Obama was just, he was kind of the naval chamberlain of the 21st century. He was too scared to go strike, you know, al-Assad in Syria. It's like, no, he, quite frankly, because Obama, and I'm speaking as an African-American who was active and voted for Obama, by the way, I personally think he was afraid of how he would come across as that mean black guy in the White House. So he did not want to do what Trump did, because he would automatically be called a dictator, because he would have bypassed Congress without getting, you know, authorization, like Trump just did. There's a lot more moving parts, and just recent history, people need to remind themselves, and I'm being euphemistic when I say remind, because people are conveniently forgetting certain things in history recently. So yeah, I have a lot more. There's a lot more to it than just, you know, him dropping Trump sending his planes over to drop, you know, missiles onto an airfield, which did not take out the chemical weapons, by the way. But everyone is just cheering him like he did something.
Yeah, no, I don't think so. I don't think everyone's cheering at all. I think there's people like us going, well, like, yeah, oh, that's a American, bummer, man. Like, what the hell? You just wasted all that? American
media, they are.
Now, I want to know, is it really even going on? Are people really getting hurt over there? What's going on, man? Like, is it really children and old people getting choked to death? Or is this all propaganda?
I think it's real, based on, you know, I haven't, you know, I don't have the means to go over there and investigate.
We That's don't really know. We're looking at pictures on the TV and thinking it's all real. That's the way I look at it now. Okay.
Personally speaking, I would suggest that the reader, because most of us don't have the means to go over and investigate for ourselves. That's why it's good to get a wide variety, and I don't mean Fox News. For me, yeah,
how can we do this? I'm just thinking, I'm just brainstorming. Right, how can we do this right now?
I'll get it from... To me, CNN's too far.
Let's go on Twitter right now on this show. Let's all three of us go on Twitter and try to find somebody in Syria and ask them what's really going on over there. Everyone in the chat room.
Done that. Everyone in the chat room. That little girl who got a lot of attention. I don't remember her name. She's here. I think she's in the United States. She finally got, her and her family finally got out. Now, mind you, a lot because this is social media, so a lot of the postings, those people are coming from Syria, they're going to be posting, it's going to be in Arabic, okay? So, because I've seen a few of them.
I've got the Translate app on mine. You can get the Translate app pretty easily. I've got it on mine. So.
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, then you just hit the nail on the head. Yeah, I suggest people to read, yes, the established, because they established news, you know, BBC, Mother Jones, even CNN, MSNBC, Stay away from Fox. Stay away from all those right-wing bastards. But I suggest that you just go ahead and just check out social media to kind of counteract some of that with the established media. But established media, we can't write them off totally. I know that, speaking as a lefty, because a lot of us lefties, we do the same thing too.
Wait a minute. Means to fly in, people in Canada don't know what a lefty is. We think it's the way that your dick goes in your pants. Left or right. That's okay. For us, a lefty is, you know, you curve to the left.
but you see what I'm saying? But we have to be able to balance it. And oh, here's another. Democracy Now! Is another good source. Amy Goodman, I have seen her in person. She came here to Lincoln, Nebraska a few years ago. Amy Goodman, Democracy Now! On the radio. Everybody can Google this, and most people probably know her. I suggest you check out these alternative people who also do news like Amy Goodman and whatnot. Again, stay away from right-winger. Do not give those people any legitimacy.
So they're
That's
righties.
That's my strong suggestions to people.
People their junk goes to the right, usually are left-handed. And that means you're a politician.
I wouldn't know because I don't look at other people.
Do you know that most politicians are all left-handed? Do you know they're all left-handed? Almost every politician's been left-handed. I wonder if Donald Trump's left-handed.
I don't know.
And it has to do something with leadership quality, too. And also,
well,
the,
Obama,
the,
I know
and
he's
also
right-handed.
The Rh negative. I believe the Rh negative factor goes into it, too, if I'm not mistaken. You guys know anything about that?
There were several presidents that were left-handed. You are right about that. But I think it's just coincidental, but there could be something, you know, maybe slightly paranoid. Not, I don't believe in, you know. There may be something more to it. You get into a lot of behavioral politics, behavioral social sciences. You know, certain personalities are attracted to certain jobs. Because if you're type A, you tend to be more into politics. Because it takes, you know, it takes a lot of, push yourself. You got to be pushy. And you got to be, you know. So you probably get more into behavioral science is probably what that's more about.
Yeah, man. Yeah, but apparently, I think, I'm pretty sure about this. Like, I'm going to Google this. We're going to take a break here, I think.
So that was our new segment.
Well, I think we may come back to that topic, but for now, let's everyone just try to, we're going to come back with some different, I think we're going to talk about Star Wars.
Skype keeps dropping out on me. Is it dropping out on you guys a little bit?
No.
What's that?
No.
Okay,
no,
good.
No, everything's clear for me.
Good. Okay.
What's going on here? Okay. All right. So, we're going to come back. We're going to take a short break here. And
okay.
If everyone could just go ahead and try to get a hold of somebody, say, through social media in Syria. And at the end of the show.
Yeah, let's do this.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, we can do that. And come back and maybe later if anybody comes up with something later we'll talk about that. Yeah, I was getting a little bit out of hand there. For a Sunday afternoon, that was terrible. Yeah, I apologize, folks. Yeah. What are we gonna come up with next here? So you went or you are going to a Star Wars convention?
Both. I went to Anaheim, California, Los Angeles, in 2015 for the Force Awakens. They call them celebrations. You know, like Comic-Con was, it's called celebrations, Star Wars celebrations. And then I'll be going this week to Orlando, Florida for the Star Wars of Orlando, SWCO, #SWCO. So yeah, so both. I've been to one in the Los Angeles area, and I'm about to go to Orlando. So it'd be my second Star Wars convention.
Yeah.
Yeah, Imperial March.
Here we go. I'll leave you with the Imperial March. We'll be back shortly on Monster Castle Paranormal Sunday afternoon show with Les. Talk. We return. And we're back. Wow, that was groovy, man. I dig that theme. Wow. Okay, let's talk about something different, totally different. Let's talk about the Star Wars conventions.
Yeah.
That's what I wanted to talk about, actually.
Sounds good.
I've never been to one.
You want me to just,
what's it
I was,
like?
I was trying to follow your lead. You want me to go?
So, yeah, because I've never been to one. And a lot of people haven't. And we want to know what we're missing. I'm a big Star Wars fan. I'm sure most of my listeners are.
Awesome. Well, I back in 2015, if you guys remember, The Force Awakens came out. And that's, of course, the most recent movie, that, you know, 2 years ago at that time, since Revenge of the Sith. So it was huge. It was held in Anaheim, California, Los Angeles area, and it was just crazy. I had never been to any convention up until that point yet. So my initiation into the convention lifestyle was a rude awakening. I mean, there were so many people there. It's like, think of a big football game, wherever it is, and you know, some of those football stadiums, like here in Lincoln, Nebraska, ours hold something like 98,000 people. It wasn't quite that big, obviously. That's like a small city within a city. But it was something, it felt like that. It was so huge, they had to organize people into different sections. And I stayed overnight when I arrived in Los Angeles and then went to Anaheim. I stayed overnight as well as thousands of other people. And so that way, because we wanted to make it into the main act, if you will, and that was the convention center in Anaheim. They had J.J. Abrams, they had Kathleen Kennedy, producer, J.J. Abrams, of course, being the director. They had Mark Hamill, Carrie Fisher. I got a chance to see her before she passed away, so I was very fortunate that way. I got a chance just to see her for like an hour. It was awesome. Anthony Daniels, Peter Mayhew, and the newcomers. They had Daisy Ridley. They had John Boyega. They had Oscar Isaacs. I'm still learning him. He's kind of new to the scene. So I got a chance to see all those people. Just, you know, they were on the stage, but we got a chance to interact. It was awesome. And that's in addition to, you know, the cosplay. And for those who don't know, cosplay is basically costume play. You know, you dress the part of some fandom, whether it's, you know, Star Trek, Star Wars, or Harry Potter, you know, whatever it is. I personally don't do that. That's just not my thing. What I do is I do a lot of Star Wars fan fiction, you know, as a science fiction writer. That's no surprise there. I've got several of them that if you just Google my name, Joseph Moore, Star Wars fan fiction, you'll probably see it. Going to the Star Wars convention, you get a chance to see the actors, the producer, the people behind it, and of course, a bunch of collecting things, and it was just wild. J.J. Abrams, shout out to him. He was so nice enough, and I think maybe Kathleen Kennedy, too. They bought, like, cheese pizza for like, those thousands of people. It wasn't thousands of pizzas now, but they, you know, just some free pieces to hold us over when we were staying over the night over in the convention center. So that's what I went through the first time 2 years ago. This time it'll be in Orlando and I take off Wednesday and it actually starts Thursday and Friday, Mark Hamill, he's going to have some kind of special, what's the word? I'm not sure what to say. I guess you could say some kind of, you know, not service is probably too strong of a word, but remembrance of Carrie Fisher. That'll be Friday. I think it's in the early evening. So I plan on going to that. I, you know, it's not like I knew her personally, but growing up as a Star Wars geek, you know, it's literally almost like losing a family member. So I plan on going that. That will definitely be very sober because it'll be the first time that we, you know, the majors, you know, Kenny Baker, the guy who played the original R2-D2. He died, I think, a couple of years ago or so. So she's not the first of the Star Wars family to
Master Mustaba. Master Mustaba. Okay, I got to ask you something. I know you're an atheist, right?
Okay.
So what do I'm really curious what a person like you would think, what's going to happen to her, like what happened to Carrie Fisher when she died?
Nothing. We just, it's just non-existence. And the body is left behind. And it's just, it's like, I was talking to someone recently and I used to use this analogy all the time. It's not a really good one. When people say you unplug a computer, it goes, well, as we all know, computers, whatever device you use, it actually retains information. So maybe that's not the best analogy to use, because some people will see that as an afterlife. It's just, we just simply, we don't exist anymore. Our consciousness is dead. And the body is still behind. It's just that simple.
We go to the same place we were before we were born.
Which is if you're talking about the consciousness, which is nowhere. Because people don't like to hear this, but we're biological machines, and our consciousness, I don't use the word spirit, I don't use the word soul, I say consciousness, because we're awake, we're sentient beings, we're aware of our surrounding and ourselves, and you know, we feel, and we also have a sense of awareness about ourselves within the universe, basically sentientness. And that's a bit deeper, because other animals are sentient too, but they don't know their place in the universe, but anyway. But no,
Force?
Well, obviously it's fiction, yeah, but it's just fiction. As big of a Star Wars geek as I am, in the end, it's fiction.
Hey, wait a minute. Some of us believe in the Force, man.
Well, they're actually in the UK. They actually recognize Jediism as actually recognized as a religion.
There you go.
The UK. That was several years, like 10 years ago, I think, close to that, when it was officially recognized as a religion somewhere in the UK. If anyone's listening by podcast and they know more about this than I do, it'd be awesome to hear them either call or to go on social media and you know, let us know if you could. And of course, listeners can Google it themselves, you know, or whatever, you know, research it. I should say research it themselves. It's out there, but yeah, it's a real religion recognized in the UK, but I don't think anywhere else. But I will say this in regard, and it kind of connects with the Star Wars things we're talking about and my atheism. This is what's interesting about what George Lucas did back, with the prequels, you know, The Force Awakens, the Revenge of the Sith and whatnot. Those who've watched Star Wars will know what I'm talking about when I say midi-chlorian.
I know exactly what you're talking about. I think you've gone. Midi-chlorian is the something they find in the blood. And
it makes them use the Force better.
Yeah, if they don't have enough midi-chlorians, then that's how they judge how powerful your Force can be. So
right, exactly. Like, and just as a reference, and it was in the very first prequel, Phantom Menace, when Qui-Gon Jinn and young Obi-Wan Kenobi, Ewan McGregor and I forgot the actor's name who played Qui-Gon Jinn. I'm sorry, I forgot his name.
Oh,
anyway,
yeah.
they're on Tatooine, and this is where they first how we first meet Anakin Skywalker when he's a little child, and they take a sample, or I should say Qui-Gon Jinn takes a sample of a young Anakin Skywalker, his blood, and his midichlorians are through the roof. They're even more than Yoda's. So quantity does matter. Fans didn't like it because a lot of Star Wars fans, they're kind of a, I like Star Trek, but not as much as they do Star Wars. It's just a different, Star Trek is kind of more of your typical science fiction, as in hard science, and then you speculate, speculative fiction, science fiction, Gene Roddenberry, and of course you think of, Arthur C. Clarke, people of that nature. Star Wars, of course, is more like science fantasy. Good versus evil, just more vague things. A lot of the fans did not like the introduction of midichlorians because it sounded too scientific to them. So they just wanted the Force to be this ethereal, this deist almost kind of thing, because a lot of these people who are Star Wars fans, I think a lot of them, I think they tie in some of their religious faith, spirituality, whatever you want to call it. And even though it's fiction, it's almost like my fellow fans, and I'm talking about like
Liam Neeson. By the way, Liam Neeson.
Liam Neeson, thank you. Excellent actor. All of them, excellent actor. And I didn't mean any disrespect towards him. I just forgot his, I'm not the best with names. But anyway, a lot of these Star Wars fans, to them, is like, no, don't make it. It's too scientific. I personally love the introductions of the midichlorians, and maybe this is the atheist in me talking, because I don't believe in spiritual stuff and, you know, the afterlife. And yeah, I'm into the paranormal, but it's really more for entertainment. But again, I'm not a debunker. I believe in investigating things.
Have you ever tried this experiment where, you close your eyes and walk towards a wall and see if you feel that somewhere? You should feel it with your sixth sense.
Actually, or have somebody walk
across the room silently, or just stretch your hand out and point at your forehead while your eyes are closed. You should feel that.
If I may, about the wall, I would suggest that, of course, as you're walking, you're going to make some noise. And whether you're breathing or whether your footsteps on the floor, it's going to bounce off and ricochet off the wall. And so it's almost like the bat senses, that's how they're able to, quote unquote, see. It's kind of like that. Yep. Even with humans, if you close your eyes, you walk closer and closer. Well, just the sound of your breathing or your footsteps are going to ricochet off that whatever item or object
it is. No, I'm talking silently, okay?
And
yeah.
So
totally that silently. Is, no noise. Absolutely no noise. Your friend just stretches his or her arm out towards you, trying not to break the air too much because we don't want air. Just very slowly, and then point at your forehead while your eyes are closed. Then there's no air, there's no sound, there's nothing. You will still feel it. I call it a sixth sense. And you will feel it.
There is energy in the body.
I
don't know how it works. It does work, but I don't know how it works.
Okay.
And maybe it's something to do with electricity and our electromagnetic field. But there is a sixth sense.
It's possible. In one of my novels, it's called The Solar Bridge, The Unintended Consequences of Time Travel. I just touch upon that just a tiny bit because that was science fiction versus paranormal. So back then, this came out back in 2005. Anyway, one of the things I dealt with was people from the future being genetically altered where they have like seven senses, and one of the senses is like they can feel color.
Okay, people can do that. Actually,
you can touch red, if you will.
Okay,
with your fingers.
Yeah. This is
without
not
touching an object.
This is not science fiction, man. They've done studies on this. This is real. Some people can feel colors. Blind people can feel colors. They can touch the paper and tell you what color it is.
What do you mean by that? You have to educate me on that. In what sense do they feel color?
This has been documented since the 60s. They've done experiments with it. Blind people just touching a paper, and when they touch red, they can say that's red. And it's proven. There's no explanation for it, but it is proven.
Okay. Well, this is one of those cases where
I forget what you call it, but this is one of the first things I studied way back in the day, man. There's definitely people that can touch colors and tell you what color it is, and they'll say it feels warmer
like
or something.
Like you talked about before, Wolfman Mike, I am a skeptic. I just, you know, and that's part of it, the atheism.
Okay.
I'm gonna
Google it right now. I'm gonna see if I can find something.
But with that said, I just want to say, but I'm also not a debunker. If there's part of the scientific method, which I strongly believe in, and secular humanist, generally speaking, we're really big on the scientific method.
Okay, here we go. Here's a topic for you. Okay, how come when blind people that have never had sight before in their life, they've never had sight, they can never see since they were a baby, they could never see, how come they can still have dreams with colors and everything in it, and that they explain to people, and seeing people the way they, and everything, like, how can they do that?
Well, I have read some things about, like, people who, you know, I've actually heard, I can't even remember the details now, but I read about this person who's got for sight for the first time in their lives, just last year, I think it was a young woman. I kind of read it a bit. I didn't really take that much. It was like, okay, cool. But so I didn't do great research on this, but this is my guess based on biology. There are certain things that human beings that we're born with, that it's almost like when you have a car, you have certain options, and some people, they don't select or they don't have certain things built in, like an extra switch for, let's say for a sunroof or a moonroof. And you just see like this little pan on your panel or your dashboard, you see like this rectangular shape, but there's nothing there. Well, unless you utilize the options method and you make a special order, or that's perhaps part of the order of a car, then they can make the car to have a sunroof. That's the closest thing I can think of, because I would have to do research on myself. I'm sorry, but I'm not going to just believe that, oh, there's some, you know, mystical reason for, there's always a logical explanation to things. We just don't know what it is yet.
Okay. How do you explain? Okay, go ahead, Darren, and then I got one.
I know a little bit about this. Blind people don't really have, they have dreams about what they experience in their world. So they don't really see things like we do. They experience it in their dream. It's different. And did you guys know that when people get their sight back, the suicide rate for those people is like 30%? It's really, really difficult for anybody to get their sight back. It just is exhausting. And they don't really, their brains didn't develop at a young age. Have you read the book Crashing Through?
No, I have not.
It was a skier that had the world record in speed skiing, and he was blind, and he got his sight back, and he talks about, you know, seeing his wife for the first time and not even knowing it was her, and just how difficult and absolutely exhausting it is for the brain to have never seen, to have to learn what things are. You'd have to touch everything to know what it is. It's a fascinating read. It's one of my favorite books of all time, if anyone has a chance to read
it. I was not aware of that. That's very interesting. And that's an example of what I mean by when you and I talked last time on the air, Wolfram and Mike. And thank you, Darren. That's an excellent example. To me, that would fall under, that makes sense. That's logical, to be honest with you.
But
it's not the same as supernatural. You know, I've got
the explanation here. Here it is.
Okay.
A blind person can feel the thermal energy deposited by light, and so can be convinced that light exists and carries energy. Then it is just a matter of description of what light is and its properties. I'm afraid that for a blind man, this may remain abstract and unverifiable, and he may just have to take his friend's word for it. But you can give a blind man a device that senses light and emits. Wait a minute.
Have you seen those blind people that use clicks just like bats, and they can ride bikes and everything else if they do it from the time they're young?
No, I personally have not seen that.
Yeah, there was a kid that would click all the time. He'd just make clicking sounds all the time, and he'd just fine.
Like with his mouth or something? Or
Yes.
That makes sense.
It wasn't the article I was looking for, but
cool. But there's always some, but anyway, that's with the midichlorians things, with the Star Wars things, that ties in with a lot of people. Most people are, and I do basically lectures or presentations, whatever you want to call them, at a university. I won't say the name, just to make sure some controversy or something doesn't come up. There's a regional university I do lectures as an atheist. I do it like two or three times a year. I used to do it with the Secular Humanist organization I helped co-found.
Wait a minute. Joseph, you got to explain to everyone what a Secular Humanist is.
Okay. Let me finish this first, and then I'll do that real quick, if that's okay. Thank you, Mike. I appreciate it. Let me say this. I'll finish this, and then I'll explain what secular humanism is, as opposed to what an atheist is. Anyway, one of the things it's my business to know about demographics. Most people are very much religious, and United States atheists people, now there are different, you can go to adherence.com, you can go to United Nations, you can go to something religious survey or something. There are different sources you can get your information from. But on, it seems like between all these different sources, atheists in the United States specifically, we only make up about 5% of the population of a nation of about 330 million. So, that's very small. So a lot of people, most people are just simply, if not religious, they're very spiritual. Unfortunately, from my perspective as an atheist, that's not going to change anytime soon. I'm very disappointed in the human race, to be honest with you guys, in that we just cannot let go of a lot of the stuff that our ancient ancestors. I can understand why astrology was around, okay, and eventually became astronomy, and because our ancestors didn't know better. They didn't have the knowledge, and they didn't have the tools of science that we have today. I get that, okay, but when 2017, and we're still talking about, anyway, people were going to believe what they want to believe, okay? On my Twitter feed, I got two Twitter feeds. I have one that's just Joseth Moore, my name, Joseth Moore, J-O-S-E-T-H, and then Moore. I just put up a bunch of stuff about my ebooks and my novels, and I tweet other people's scientific or, science fiction or science-related
live
stuff.
Science.
I leave
she
that
can
alone.
Also
I don't
taste them and hear
much.
Them and smell them. The 20-year-old junior at the University of Maine has synesthesia, a rare neurological condition in which two or more of the senses entwine. Numbers and letters, sensations and emotions, days and months are all associated with colors for Carrie.
Okay, that's
okay.
This is an
all right.
That is not the exact one, but these kids can smell and taste colors.
Okay. All right. Let me finish this up real quick for you, and then we'll go on that tangent. Let me finish this up real quick. I know I'm going along. That's the unfortunate side effects of education. You learn a lot, so you tend to speak a lot. So I'll try to keep it a little bit shorter. Atheists are just basically people who do not believe in the notion of any gods at all, okay? The reason why I say it that way, because most people, when you say, I don't believe in God, because of course, we're in a society, a Western society that's mostly Christian. We're used to talking about the monotheistic notion of a God. Well, of course, there are thousands, like 4,000 religions on the earth. There are several pantheistic religions. So I say gods, not just the Christian gods, not just the Muslim gods, not just the Judeo-Jewish gods, gods in general. We just don't believe in the existence of any gods, okay? That's what an atheist is. Secular humanist. I'm not going to go into like where the Latin phrase came and all this other stuff, but basically it's like separation of church and state. Secular means of this tangible world. Secular. If you take your dollar, this is not just in the United States. So if anybody besides the United States, whoever has an American dollar bill, the $1 bill, flip that on the back. Look at the seal of the Great Seal of the United States. You'll see the pyramid with the floating eye. I believe it says something about secular, New World Order and all this other stuff. That's where you can see the word secular. That just means of this tangible world. New World Order is what that basically says in the dollar bill. Secular humanism. Now, humanism, and this actually goes, and again, I'm not going to go on too long. That basically, this goes back to the European times of the Renaissance. That is because of humanists from Europe during the Renaissance era. That is why we have astronomy. Sorry, that is why we have biology and chemistry, and why we have satellites. Because a lot of such as Galileo and Copernicus and Kepler and there are all these other people that we've forgotten and don't know about back in the European times. Because it was dangerous to not believe in some notion of God, God back then, or not to be in a church. Galileo is a good prime example of that. And so a lot of these people, they actually had to be careful talking about science, the sun being the center of the solar system. Well, because in the Bible, you think it's, that's where the humanism comes in secular humanism. It's just of this tangible world, And not that it's against religion, it's just neutral to the issue of religion. That's why those who follow American politics, that's why you hear such a stink that we're going through about this separation of church and state, you know, the transgender versus, you know, all this other stuff. And because if we had secularism throughout this whole world, trust me, we would not have the problem in the Middle East we do today, because a lot of these people try to have theocratical societies where they try to force other people to live like them and their religious viewpoints.
Well,
that's why it's
we're going to break, Joseph. We're going to break,
okay.
Buddy. Save
okay.
Your thought. Yeah, all right.
Oh, thank you.
Sunday
and
afternoon.
Awesome. Thank you.
Groovy. It's groovy with the Wolfman. Sunday afternoon. All right. Can you dig it? KTLK, thefringe.fm. We'll be back with this secular humanist in a few minutes here. Okay, and we're back on. All right. Everybody who would like to raise your midichlorian level, we have a new drink for you. It's called midichlorian ale. And Wolfman Mike is going to be producing some midichlorian ale and put it on the market very soon for everyone that wants to raise your midichlorian level. Just drink a lot of this beer, and you will raise your midichlorian levels. All right, midichlorian ale / Wolfman Mike / MonsterCastleParanormal.com. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Oh, God.
I'd buy that.
Midichlorian ale. You can't get it anywhere else.
I will be drinking.
Only available on the KTLK network, thefringe.fm. Midichlorian ale, all right.
That was fantastic.
Yeah.
Well, Ben, you never failed to surprise me. That was perfect. You can use that later as a drop.
Yep. I was thinking the same thing. I just did a live drop there.
Oh, we're still off air?
No, we're live. I just did a live drop on the air.
It's hard to tell. Sorry. It's hard to tell.
All right.
Well, what's up, guys?
We're thinking Atheist.
And I will breathe. I will give more breaks so you guys can come in more.
Okay.
Okay.
You must have some questions, Darren.
I do. I was wondering, is there anything that is good about religions, do you believe?
When you leave it.
Okay. What was your model of
I'm not going to counterbalance what I believe just to make people feel there's nothing good about religion, in my personal opinion. Yes, there are people who do good things, who are religious. They have the motivation because they read in the Bible, be good to each other, or whatever book. Whatever they read. But that's because they've read, which is a good notion, but they've done it on their own. And there are a lot of people, such as myself, who are atheist, or maybe perhaps they're deist, which is still spiritual, which is not atheist. We do good too, but we don't go around broadcasting it, and then we don't stick some kind of symbol with it, and then have some congregation. And it's, you can do good just being an atheist, and you can still do good even as a Christian or whatever religion you're in. There's nothing good about religion per se, but there's nothing really bad about it either per se. And in the end, it's just like what you hear about the political arguments throughout the world now. Well, I read the truth is in the Bible, especially in the Old Testament, homosexuals were supposed to be stoned, correct? Am I correct?
Stoned. I don't know about that. I'm not going to agree or disagree.
Yeah, you were not supposed to tolerate homosexuals. For sure.
See that in the Bible to believe that. I don't know about that one.
No, I used to be a deacon in my father's church.
Okay.
I read the Bible a lot. That's one of the things. There are a lot of people you're supposed to stone from adulteress. And notice this adulteress, the woman.
Stoning is a terrible way of death, yeah. Man. It's brutal.
But so what I'm doing is answering the question here. So what I'm saying is, now that's in the Bible or in the Torah. So now is that inherently bad as a religion, or is it because people choose to interpret something they read in the Bible or the Quran or the Torah or whatever other literature?
Can you imagine
act on it in such a way? It depends on the people.
Think about this. Can you imagine trying to govern a people that are willing to throw stones at their children and bludgeon them to death, the community gathering around and actually throwing stones at this one person and all in fury and just killing the person and then walking away and thinking they did something for God?
Did you guys hear about the gay couple in Thailand last week? There's like a 24-year-old and a 21-year-old that were having a relationship, and they had to have 100 caning, 100 lashes of the cane.
Yeah, well, anyways, what I'm trying to say is that the people back then had a different moral code than we do now. So,
and they weren't very educated about
the Bible back then was written for people with that mentality. now. We don't stone people anymore, so.
Joseph, what would your model of the perfect world be? Like, if 95% of people believed what you did, how would you see the world at that point? How do you think it would be?
Well, and I understand you're just being hypothetical. To me, yes. The quote-unquote perfect world would be, you would think I would say everyone is an atheist. So that could be one of them. But in the perfect world, people would accept us atheists for who we are and not have to have laws where you cannot be in office in the White House. You couldn't even be in the White House. You couldn't be in Congress as an atheist.
What?
I think some.
Are you serious?
I think they've changed some of that recently. I'm no expert on, but I heard or read about that. But the perfect world would be.
Yeah, how are we going to get you to swear on the Bible?
Atheists are accepted amongst religious people, but also we just live in unison. I mean, I don't want religion. Okay, my wife is Christian, everyone, okay? So obviously, and we've been married for over six and a half years, close to seven now. So obviously, I don't hate Christians, okay? The perfect world, quote unquote, would be if everyone, including atheists with religious people, and other faiths, we just live together. It doesn't mean that you guys have to become atheists like me for it to be a perfect world. If I said that, to me, there's something wrong with me.
No, I think
of
you're right.
With the religion,
so
I would like to
just imagine a world, you know, a humanistic world where we take care of each other, but you know, there is no religion. You know, what would that be like?
Well, it's you. Okay, here's a practical example of what it could be like. Stem cell research. I remember reading this like I guess close to 20 years, well, actually over 20 years ago now. I remember when stem cell research really started to blast off 20-something years ago. And remember the guy who cloned Dolly the sheep? I think he's Scottish, I think, if I remember correctly. It's been years since I read about it. But anyway, well, he had to leave the United States and other people to conduct stem cell research. And that's because a lot of, and I really need to do a better job of researching some of the, but I didn't expect to talk about this stuff, to be honest with you, because I read about it years ago and talked about it. I'd forgotten all about it. But because of so many religious objections, because some, you know, it's the thing about abortions, because there's this, people think that people are aborting fetuses so they can do stem cell research. Now, as I understand, if I remember correctly, some of the research was from, some of it was from discarded embryos or, you know, fetus, you know, during abortions. But it wasn't that they went around and killed or, well, I'll use the word aborted, excuse me, aborted fetuses or embryos in order to do a stem cell research. That's not why. But because of the religious objections, a lot of scientists who were in the field of stem cell research, they had to, frankly, most of them went to Europe. And because of the now there's 20 years later, there is a lot of more advances in stem cell research. And when you know that basically a cell can become, long story short, a cell starts off with a clean slate. If you give it the right message, if you will, that cell can turn into an ear when you form as you know, from the embryo to, you know, fetus. Or it can form into a nose. It can, you know, your eyes. There are certain DNA, you know, cells that are formed for certain parts of the bodies of the organ that makes
human beings.
I saw that. And
that mouse that had an ear that grew on its back.
Right. But the advances that could help with a lot of our people with our medical advances, but we're stymieing ourselves because of a lot of religious objections. And that's okay that people don't want to. If they don't want a blood transfusion because of the Jehovah's Witness, I'm okay with that. But making laws to reflect your personal religious belief, that actually, that I think we talked about this the last time I was on, Mike, Wolfman Mike. It's called the Establishment Clause for the United States, where Congress shall not establish a religion. That's the first part of that clause.
Oh, but you have to swear. Wait a minute. You can't establish but you got to swear on the Bible when you're in court. Does that make any sense?
Bingo.
Does that make any sense at all?
You hit the nail on the head. The first part of the clause is A and B. Part A, Congress shall make no establishment of religion, comma, or whatever. And then there's the other half of it that a lot of people take.
Well, you know, it's contradictory.
And nor should Congress infringe upon people to practice their religion. That's a paraphrase.
Okay, so but yet you have to swear on a Bible when you go to court. How does that make any sense at all? That's totally contradictory, and what they're really saying is something else, because when you go to court, you got to swear on a Bible, and that's the Bible of Christian Bible, so no matter what religion you are, they put this thing in front of you and make you put your hand on it and swear on it.
Exactly, and that not only that, but in the U.S. Congress, which I've been to the U.S. Capitol, by the way, and I did some lobbying for environmental situation.
It's hypocritical. That's what I'm trying to say. It's hypocritical.
Now, they've been opening up for prayer besides Christians. They've been more ecumenical, however you pronounce that, where it's different religions. But the point is, that's where a lot of us secularists, that's why you hear a lot of us complaining, because it's in the Constitution, which these conservatives love to talk about. They love them some the Constitution. But I remember when Ted Cruz was running for president, I heard him actually say it was a myth of the separation of church and state. That's interesting. He's a really smart man, as much as I disagree with him, and I can't stand his politics. He is smart. He knows better, because it is in the Establishment Clause. Congress should not establish a religion, but nor shall it infringe upon people who do practice it. And that's why a lot of us do have objections when they do the swearing in on the or any. It's not just the Christian. And real quick, I said this before the last time I was on. I'm going to say it again. A lot of, and I do mean Christians, fundamentalist Christians, a lot of them think when they hear the word atheist, those who know what it is, because a lot of them don't, I'm learning, they automatically think, oh, that's just code word for I'm not Christian. And everything else is out the door. There was someone I met from New York. Well, she's just outside New York City, one of the boroughs. I won't say where. She was a guest over at my wife and I house. We were chatting. And I told her that I was an atheist. And she's like, oh, you believe in many gods. I was like, no, that's pantheism.
Can I say something?
You know,
again,
hi, Kurt.
I'm a lecturer, guys. I can go on and, you know,
Kurt Green here. From everyone, welcome, Kurt Green.
How do you do?
But a lot
What's
of people don't know.
His name is Joseph, Joseph. It's a TH, so Joseph. And,
Joseph.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
So welcome, Kurt Green, everyone. Welcome.
I was thinking about Jehovah's Witness. You know what? In the end, if you think about. I don't want anybody else's blood in me either. Now, if you think about it, they have that right. But now, if a child has like appendicitis, they'll pray over him and let him die. Now that's wrong. So the authority should step in then. But I think they had something right. I don't want to have anybody else's blood. If you need, you can go ahead of time and then have your own blood drawn. A week ahead of surgery, but I wouldn't want Wolfman's blood in me, no.
Oh, yeah, you would. You're going to get fire in your veins, buddy. Oh,
we get drunk immediately.
It's going to be fire and electricity. You won't even imagine what's going to happen to you then. You'll get the DNA of the Anunnaki, man. The DNA of the Anunnaki. Oh, yeah.
I reject that in Jesus' name right now.
You're going to become a Nephilim, Nephilim. You will.
No, but no,
I already
really
think
no.
you think about it,
you know, we all have our own blood.
And, how tall are you, Kurt? How tall are you?
6'2".
That's what I figured. You're a pretty tall guy. You got Nephilim blood.
Oh, you know, short. How tall are you? Like, what, 5 foot? 5 foot? What?
Kurt's got Nephilim blood, yeah.
I'm sorry, brother.
He is one of them. Is your head shaped kind of conical?
Can I ask Kurt something?
Yeah.
You still there, Kurt? Curtis. I'm sorry, Curtis. You still there, Curtis?
Yeah, Kurt.
You still there?
Kurt, are you there? What's going on here?
No, I was going to ask him what really, because I went on mute.
I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. Yeah, he wants to ask you a question.
Okay, sure.
What religion and or denomination are you, if you don't mind me asking, Curtis? And if you don't want to say it on, that's, I understand. That's since
oh,
we're
no,
in
I don't
a
care.
Discussion about
I'm
it.
On my show, you heard me tell, I'm one-on-one. It's a personal relationship with Christ. Me and him,
okay.
One-on-one, he and I. But I was brought up First Southern Baptist when I was growing up. But I experienced all the holy rolling and tongue talking. And
yeah,
I went to Catholic Church, Baptist Church. I've been to the Presbyterian. I've done all of them. But I'm nothing now, just he and I. That's what I do now.
Okay, fair enough.
I was just
curious where you're coming from. The rolling, I understand. I was raised Pentecostal. I'm atheist now, but I know what it is
atheist.
To be a believer.
No.
You know, the speaking
why
in tongues
atheist?
And all that. What's that?
Oh, you're atheist?
Have you been listening to the show, Curtis?
No, I just got on a little while ago.
All right, well, that's what I'm talking about.
I thought you heard me last time I was on. I thought you heard that I was an atheist.
No, I didn't. I'm sorry. You don't believe in our Creator? Nothing?
I don't believe in the concept of any gods, period.
Wow.
Gods, plural. Not just your Christian God, Curtis.
There aren't
gods.
There's just one God. There's no gods.
Well, that's what you believe. Okay. But anyway, so that I wanted to ask you. Thank you for answering that, Curtis. I was just curious.
Okay. Well...
Joseph.
I had to take care of my doggy.
Do you think we're just afraid not to believe?
Could you say that again, please, Darren?
Are we just afraid not to believe?
Yes. So what I personally believe. Personally speaking, if I may, first I'll speak from my personal perspective. I won't go on too long. When I was a believer, Pentecostal, I basically, by the time I was 34, around the year 2004, I was pretty much an atheist by then. So I really haven't been an atheist all that long, really, technically speaking, more like 13 years. But I know that some people, when I talk to, it's almost like, I forgot, there's a phrase that a lot of atheists, when we talk about you guys, it's almost like insurance claim that a lot of believers, and I don't mean just Christians, but any religion, but in particular, the three largest ones. Well, not largest, because I should say, you know, Islam and Christianity. It seems like a lot of people, they question if there really is an afterlife and therefore a God. And some people really, they're not really exactly convinced, but they're afraid for two reasons. A, because they're afraid that, well, if there is no God, as they would say, if there's no God and no afterlife, well, then that means I just go basically to oblivion and there's nothing after this. That is horrific to think about, but it is death. And so I think some people get scared about that. Second part why I think they kind of, like you said, Darren, more or less scare themselves into their beliefs or their religion is, of course, societal. So going to church or going to temple or going to whatever. And remember, I was born Christian, so I know how it works. A lot of people, they go for social reasons. They don't want to be shut out of their families, which didn't quite happen with me when I became an atheist, but I was definitely put on the back burner, so to speak. But my family treats me well. They're still Pentecostal. We disagree, and if things are, it's we just learn to not talk about certain things, and every now and then a big argument erupts, but then we move on. But yeah, I you're right, Darren. I do believe that some people, they suspect that there is no afterlife and there aren't any gods, but they're afraid to face, from my perspective as an atheist, the reality there aren't any gods or afterlife, and it's too hard for them to deal with, so they kind of just believe anyway. And of course, the societal part of it is they don't want to be shut out of their families. They don't want to be shut out of jobs, because I've known atheists who've lost their jobs because of it. You know,
and then
so,
you could take it one
I
step farther,
you're onto something, Dan.
And other people are terrified of going to hell.
Okay, we got a question.
Like eternity.
We got a question for you, Darren, from the chat room. What is your opinion on Scientology?
I don't like Scientology, really. I had some cousins that were in there. There's parts of it I kind of like. Okay. I like the fact that
keyword for drinking is what tonight also.
This afternoon.
You have to name that as well as your answer for the question.
Why don't we do religion?
I think that's a good one.
Anytime we talk, we're talking about religion the whole time. Okay,
if
as soon
you had
as
you
to say,
pick a favorite religion, which
whenever
religion
we say
would
religion,
you pick, Joseph?
Oh my God!
If you had to have one, what would be your favorite?
Darren, before I answer that, can I ask you why that you specifically don't like Scientology? If you don't feel comfortable talking about it, I understand. I'm just curious why specifically Scientology.
I have something to say.
I saw that documentary about Scientology where they record everybody and then they kind of use it against them. I don't know if that's true, but that's the part I didn't like. I do like the part where they can take a beating and not let it affect them, you know?
You know what's weird?
You can only control yourself. I like that part.
What's weird is that Stabby seems to be...
Hold on, I have to go outside real quicker, guys. I have to go outside.
Okay.
And it's break time. It's break time anyway, man. It is break time.
I'm outside. Go ahead. Sorry.
It is break time anyways. It is break time. So anyway, I find it really strange that Stabby's reading my mind because I was going to put a reggae song on and he made a comment with a Jamaican accent in the chat room. This is crazy. And this is the second time it's happened tonight and it seems like he's reading my mind. I don't get it. How's he doing that? Barrington Levy.
I'm a
hypocrites, baby.
John Tom gone tell me speak. They always think of me and I don't see them. But one thing more, I've got to control. Excuse me while I smoke my spliff. So you see, you got a little time to sniff.
Man, far out. Okay, what's wow. really far out is that. Okay, I was looking at the songs by Barrington Levy. I saw one called "Sense Amelia," and I was thinking, "All right, yeah, spark it up, man." And that was the thought in my head. Just when I had that thought in my head, in the chat room, Stabby McHuggs writes the exact words in the chat room that I was thinking. I'm not even kidding. I'm going back on it. Something about sparking it up.
Can I say something?
That's weird. I just found that really, really weird. There was another word before that. I know what's going on here, man. Yeah, here it is. Spark it up, man. Like, with an extended man, like a Jamaican accent, possibly. Like, just exactly what I was thinking. Wow. I'm not making this up, guys. That's freaking me out. I wouldn't even said anything about sparking
I believe
up.
You.
Oh, my Lord.
That's just like too much synchronicity there, man. That's freaky.
Can I say something?
Yeah.
To the your atheist guest, brother.
Yes.
You know, if I did not know my God as I do, and I didn't know a thing, and I would turn the TV on. Now, let me finish and don't interrupt. And see the craziness on TV and begging for money and all these. And they all have 8 mansions. And I hear about Jim Jones back in the old day, kill 1,000 people drinking cyanide. And I see Muslims doing what they do. And I see, I wouldn't want to believe in God either, so I understand.
No, that's not why, though.
Well, I'm just saying that that's where I'm coming from. I see all the craziness. There's like a 1,000 denominations, and they all fight against one another and believe different. I've been to a Pentecostal church where the whole preaching been on putting down the Baptist.
Do they ever have fist fights, Kurt? You ever seen a fist fight?
In the old days, my grandma said, in the old days, the Baptists and the Methodists would go out in the barn and argue, and they'd get angry and leave angry.
Did they ever beat each other up?
No.
No.
Shut up. Probably. Well, it eventually got. What was that? What was that? Zombie Land. Remember Zombie Land, where it got so bad that that's what happened. It may get that way. I don't know. But if I didn't know God and I saw what I see on TV and 30 denominations and people killing people, hitting people over the head. You got to go up to the front of the church and get hit over the head, and then they use rattlesnakes in some churches.
It's interesting that you say that, Curtis, because part of my lecture I do at that university,
I don't want to know.
I have.
You got.
It's called behavior.
That,
I call
I don't
it.
Know. I don't.
I call it behavioral.
No.
I call it behavioral atheism. What I mean by that is what you just said, Curtis,
sorry.
And that's a good example. Some people say they're atheists when they experience bad things in their lives. They lose loved ones or something really bad. You know, they lose a job after they prayed and God
to get hit in the head.
You know, and then they get mad.
Get
and I'm not going to go to church. And I'm telling you from experience from people that I talk with. And they say, I'm an atheist. I stopped going to church. But that's not atheism. That's because it's understandable that some people get upset and then they question their faith. That's just questioning your faith, or you're mad at what you perceive as a God. In my case, for me personally, Curtis specifically, since you asked this, for me, okay, it was took me years to become before I became a full-fledged atheist. I would say that what germinated was education. When I went to University of Nebraska in Lincoln, here in Lincoln, Nebraska, I went to school for the fine arts, which means humanities. Humanities equals science. I studied astrology, or I keep saying that. I studied astronomy, anthropology, sociology, biology, and some other sciences. That germinated, but I didn't become an atheist until I was in my 30s. So for me, it's just logical. It's for me personally, everyone's different, but for me personally, it is not behavioral atheism. It's not because I experience something bad or because I see people, what they do in churches, they're hypocritical and, oh, they're being hypocrites, I'm going to become an atheist. I think that's a bad reason to become an atheist, but, you know, everyone each their own. It's just for me personally.
Did you have something?
It's not logical. It's not logical that some being, and there are literally thousands of religions on the earth. You guys can't all be right. So how is it that one believes that the creation from the Bible, the book of Genesis, and then all these other religions, they have their tales of how the earth came about and the universe. So, I mean, they can't all be right at the same time, right? That's just not logical. So for everyone's got their thing. You know, I'm not criticizing people who do have faith or religion, whatever. I just don't want them to try to legislate their religion on me. That's all I ask. And it is, well, from the United States anyway. It is constitutional, separation of church and state. That's not to you guys, hint, hint, to those in the office now. But that's where I'm coming from, Curtis. And I was raised
Pentecostal. I understand completely.
So
I do understand.
So it's not that I – well, sorry, go ahead. I'm sorry, Curtis. Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, I was just – I noticed that you said if I didn't know God either. Well, I was raised Pentecostal. I was very much a believer. I used to fast on my own. I fasted 3 days once. No water or anything like that. I went to church. I became a deacon in my father's church, and I would go out and witness to people and all this other stuff. But you know, some people,
that might have been part of it.
Do you miss it at all?
What's that?
Do you miss having faith? Was it more fun believing, or is it more fun not believing?
Well,
what kind of question is that?
I get what you're saying,
that's
Darren.
A good one.
For me, it's not really a fun about either way, to be honest with you. I feel more free now as a human being. As the way I heard it described before, it's almost as if you walk into the store and there's no one minding the store. That you're not looking over your shoulder anymore. I'm not worried about what some god might think might strike me with the lightning or something because I say shit.
Right.
And I'm going to hell because I say shit.
Oh no!
And
that
what
won't,
about people
no.
who murdered people?
Talking on a Sunday afternoon about.
I'm classified with people
really
to go to hell because
story.
I say shit. I'm using that as one example.
I'm sorry, but you're
it
not
just
allowed
doesn't
to say
make
that.
Any sense to me. I'm sorry. You know, each their own.
You can't
but
say
now,
that
you
on
ever,
Sunday
about
are you ever,
me,
just a couple more questions, then you can tell your story. Are you ever amazed that we exist at all? I mean, just with the complexities
of
this world.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Like winning, I think Stabby says like winning the cosmic lottery, that we're here, alive.
Yeah.
What do you think?
I mean, it is pretty amazing. Like life happens. I mean, just because we don't know it doesn't. And I said this before last time I was on the air and with you guys. And I'm not going to try to repeat too much of myself, but it's kind of like I use the example just because we. Somebody with a car. I'm outside right now. Just because we don't understand at the moment doesn't mean there's no logical explanation. back in the time of Leonardo da Vinci, he had the concept of the fourth sight of flight. Wasn't quite right in his designs, but he had the basic idea. It took, of course, hundreds of years before we learned to fly, you know, with the Wright brothers. And now we're talking about flying in space, okay? Well, it took hundreds of years, but we didn't know at the time. We don't know now, the best that scientists can figure is from the Big Bang, and they're able to use scientific methods, and it's basically based on Doppler shift, red shift and red shift, blue shift. Red shift, the stars and everything is moving away from you. Blue shifts, things are moving close to you. And everything is red shift. That's how they can tell that the universe is expanding. That's how astronomers are able to do that, because that means stars and the galaxies and other astronomical bodies are shifting, or not shifting, but they're moving away from each other. But again, not to get too much into the weeds of science, but that's, you know, I am amazed that we're here, but that doesn't therefore mean, oh, must be a God that created it.
Right.
I don't know how it happened, but
just a lot of time and a lot of.
To me, it'd be more remarkable that there was some being that was just hanging around in, well, we can't say the universe, because if he created the universe, then what the hell was around? And all of a sudden, he and it's usually he just decides to create the universe out of nowhere, and now we're here, and to what purpose? And to me, that's just not congruent.
No, I hear you.
Are you all right, man? Joe, are you all right? Joseph?
Who, me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm fine.
We're not pissing you off, are we?
Could you say it again, please?
We're not pissing you off, are we?
Oh, no. I'm just okay. When it comes down to the
because,
subject.
Yeah,
see, last
I know,
time,
we're coming
no,
at you with all kinds
we
of...
We didn't talk about religion quite as much. I'm just very passionate about the issue of religion and atheism. That's all.
It's got to be hard. No, it's true. It's got to be hard being an atheist like that. I think it's got to be hard because it's such an opposing view to everyone else's that, it's got to be difficult to withhold that and stand your ground, you know. It's very different, like for us to that, like me, I have spiritual beliefs. I believe in Mother Gaia. I believe the sun is sentient. I believe the earth is sentient. I think there's some kind of cosmic consciousness. I don't call it God or anything like that, but I do believe in something. But, I don't know. It's kind of hard to just not. Do you think when you die that you're done and you just fizzle out and that's it? And my brother is the same way as you. He's an atheist as well. I find it very difficult.
Same as you, that's not atheism though, because what you're describing, Michael, Mike, is I'm laughing because we talked about how to call you during the break. Because that's more of deist, and deist is you know another form of deism. You know, like deity. So it's deism basically is a vague notion or a vague belief of some god or gods that created the universe. But yet that said deity does not interject itself into our everyday lives like what we're used to in Christianity. And like this deity or deities created the universe and they just kind of step back a little bit. And you're kind of more spiritual. So that's kind of more of a deist. A lot of people I hear who say that they're atheists, they talk like that, and they confuse atheism with that. And that is not atheism. That is more of deism, and if people don't like the label of deism, then maybe you could say, I'm not even sure if agnostic is even the right word, because agnosticism is just simply, you just can't know. The literal translation is not being able to know. A lot of people use the label agnosticism or agnostic wrongly.
How do you
they
explain
say sitting on the fence?
Okay, how do you explain these people in hospitals that are clinically dead, and they've done experiments where they put pictures up in the ceiling or in the rooftop or something, and they go up there with their out of body experience when they're dead, and then look at that picture and then come back with to life and then explain what the picture is, and there's no way that they could have known that.
Well, my response to that is, first and foremost, I always would have to read or see the case itself. So until I see or research it myself, so that's the, just kind of a given right there. Secondly, well, it's possible you kind of the first words out of your mouth was clinically. It's possible that they were never actually dead and their eyes were partially open, and there is a subconscious. It's possible they saw that item on the ceiling, and when they woke up, the brain brought it back up to their memory. So again, logical. It's just if we dig a little deeper, do a little bit more critical thinking.
To me, logic. Like, you know, yes. The logical thinking to me.
Hello. Can I say something?
Okay. Hang on. One more thing for me.
Okay.
One more thing for me. Our sun is flying through the galaxy and the universe, flying through. And how do you explain that we don't run into things? Like, don't you think that sun is kind of guiding us in a way that we don't run into shit? Flying through space like that?
I don't think it's guiding us. It's just, I mean, there's a reason why I'm not trying to be funny here. Seriously, Michael. There's a reason why they call it space, because like Alpha or the Andromeda system, the closest, well, major galaxy. There are like minor galaxies too close to us, but the Andromeda is the largest. It's something like 2.5 million light years from our galaxy. Light years. Light travels something like 100.
Yeah, but there's all kinds of particles. There's all kinds of micro particles and micrometeors and stuff like that, and gases and all kinds of things we can encounter in space that's in between stuff.
But I was going to say that part too, Michael. Actually, we do run into things. That's why the dinosaurs aren't here.
Okay.
Approximately 66 million years ago, it does happen. Well, where is the protection there?
I guess you're right on that one. Okay. I believe we got Dave Cruz with us.
I'm not trying to be argumentative. I'm just saying, if we take the
time, Mike,
just kind of
right on, brother.
Okay, Curtis wanted to say something. I believe if that's
okay.
Not Michael.
Go ahead. I don't have nothing to say.
No. Really, I'd like to hear what you wanted to say.
So much now. Where do I start?
Well, from the beginning.
One thing I'll say that when you were talking about the people in the hospital and they see the in the roof and the pictures or whatever, my brother one day out here right in the same house, he choked me. We were horseplaying and he choked me so bad that I went under and I saw a light, not a bright light, just a light, and all about 20 or 30 people in my family praying. They were all praying different prayers, but I saw them. I was dead and they prayed me back. And that's forever. I think about that every day, by the way. So I know I was right there on the verge of death. Scotty, he's dead now. He killed himself. But he did that to me.
Sorry.
Now I get to tell you. But that was true. And that let me know. And I knew them in that the atmosphere. Just I can't just tell you when you think about it where you're sitting. The atmosphere, the moment, the day, the year, him looking at me, him choking me. Going under, seeing all your great, great, greats and knowing them instinctively, like the love for your mother, and knowing it. And then they pray, all of them praying, and they prayed me back. And I came back, cried. I ran into the phone. Oh, Scotty, and I ran and called my Mammy Thelma, called my grandma. Scotty just almost killed me. I saw my grandparents. I remember all that day so vivid. But that happened. That let me know, amongst other things, why are snowflakes perfect shapes? Why?
Well, that's
just
to do with the way things are made.
Just a fluke.
In vacuum, they tested that in the International Space Station.
Everybody Googles snowflakes.
Things radiate without gravity.
You tell me there's not a god or a being or somebody in control that make you Google snowflake. Every one is different. All the snow all over the earth, different. And I'll be quiet now.
No, you're fine. You don't have to be quiet.
I bet all the grains of sand are different, too.
Go ahead, Darren. You please go ahead.
Actually, no. Dave's here with a question from Beyond the Strange.
Oh, okay.
Dave?
Hey, Mike.
How you doing, brother?
Thanks for having me on.
Awesome to have you. We're privileged.
Very interesting. I feel privileged. Hey, hi, Kurt. Hey, Darren.
Hey.
I'm sorry, guest. I just tuned in. I didn't get your name.
It's Joseph.
Joseph.
Hey, Joe. How you doing?
It looks like Joseph, but it has a TH instead of a PH. So Joseph.
Joseph.
Joseph. That's a cool name.
Thank you.
So are we talking about like after death,
yeah,
philosophies or just beliefs or
We're talking about basically anything. Yeah. He is an atheist, and I'm trying to present evidence of the otherwise.
How would you?
Well, I mean, look at the paranormal. I mean, there's so many unanswered questions about, you know, all the weird things that are happening in this world as we speak. You know, I mean, it's to me, that tells me a lot. I mean, I grew up in a religious background, and I'm pretty much a reformed apostolic assembly of God, whatever you want to call it. But that doesn't mean I don't believe
we got
something
in there. In Lincoln, Nebraska. Go ahead. I'm sorry. I'm listening.
No, and I'm just saying that you know, I think, you know, it's important that we all have something to believe in. I mean, some people choose to believe in themselves, and they believe that they can manifest, you know, God within themselves.
Well, when you say believe in something, do you mean like as in, like, I believe you can do whatever you want to do, you can go to school, you can achieve to be a doctor, and that kind of belief? Or do you mean like you have to believe in something in the supernatural? I'm not sure in what context you mean by that.
I think for every individual, it's different, and it's up to them.
I'm guessing you mean the context of supernatural is my guess.
Okay, can you...
Now, if you want to say that you, like my daughters, like I believe in my daughters that they can achieve what they want to... You know, those vague aphorisms that we tend to say, which I do, which is true. I do believe in, you know, I believe in my wife, that she's very intelligent. I believe in people like that, but like a supernatural belief, I don't. You know, and I'm not going to just to, you know... It's because it just doesn't make any sense. I've been there. It's not like I was raised atheist and I never experienced religion, everyone. I was raised Pentecostal. And plus I visited other denominations within Christianity. Even when I was in New York City family, we in Harlem, we visited a Baptist church out there. And here in Lincoln, Nebraska, visited St. Mary's in downtown Lincoln, Nebraska, Catholic. And other Pentecost. So it's, you know, it's not like I haven't had any exposure to it.
Okay, I want to know. Joseph, can you hear me? What I want to know is if you've had any paranormal experiences, like out of body experiences, like a near death experience, like Kurtz or anything like that, where.
I have not. Absolutely, okay. I have not. But closest thing, you and I talked about that last time, was my brother and I, we were really young, like about 10.
Read someone else's
like
thoughts?
Someone dragging their feet.
What about when reading someone's thoughts? Something simple, like just you two people saying the same word at the same time, and you wonder, how the hell does that happen?
That's just coincidence.
I don't think so. There's no such thing as coincidence.
If you apply to a specific situation, like let's say my wife and I were talking about a movie and we happen to say Vin Diesel at the same time. Well, you know,
okay, that's different.
Yeah,
Jesus,
right there.
Yeah, but that's way I'm talking about like what happened to me and Stabby in the chat room on this show now.
Yeah,
like that's
yeah.
way off topic, has nothing to do with anything we were talking about. And
I think it's just
what I was thinking, he wrote it at the same time I was thinking it.
I just honestly think it's just a coincidence.
That can't be a coincidence. The chances of that are a million, thousand, billion to one.
All right. What about
does he ever wake up and
there's
a digital clock like 1:11 or 2:22 or 3:33? Yeah. Do you ever wake up and your clock like that?
1:12, yeah.
I've also woken up, Curtis.
Good question, Kurt.
I've woken
that's
up
God.
When it says
that is
5:31. I've seen clocks say different things. I know what you're talking about, guys. I'm not making fun of you. I've heard about
that,
the 1:11, or excuse me, 11:11.
That doesn't necessarily mean
the
it's God talking to him.
Well, you shouldn't wake up at 3:33 and look at something's.
I was just, you know, I was
no,
taking
it doesn't
a point.
Necessarily
I was
mean
deeper
God.
Something going on. Deepa.
No. I think Stabby has magic
now, Darren,
powers.
Were you trying to say something, Darren, or?
What's that?
I thought I heard you trying to say something, maybe.
I think Dave.
I kind of want to hear, you know, where we could go in the future if we could just shed our religious beliefs. You know, what you think we could do? What would the world be like?
I think we would be more advanced scientifically speaking. And I already used the real life example of stem cell research, because a lot of times religion is, I personally think, religion / faith, I think a lot of times it's an Achilles heel of humanity that we could have advanced more. You know, some people were opposed to, of course, like I said, stem cell research, and, you know, some people are opposed to other, like, you know, blood transfusions for certain religions and. But, you know, everyone has their right to believe. But I think we'd be more scientifically advanced. I think racism would not be so prevalent. It would still be around, but not as much. Because if you're open to scientific process and scientific method and seeing how things really are, it tends to make you more open-minded. And yes. I personally think we would be more advanced. I suppose one can also look at other societies that are more secular. That's to say, have less religion in it, and in your life, you know, and compare it to more religious countries or states in the United States. You can just or Providence in your guys' Providence. What do you guys call it in Canada? Is it Providence?
Oh yeah, provinces. Yeah, we're up for a break here, man.
Excuse me, sorry.
We're up for a break, guys. And all right,
sign you out.
It's break time. We're gonna take a little break for everybody right now. All right.
You literally had ghosts calling on a ghost box, but you're going to lose a lot of credibility.
Lake Moss are gobbling you up in one fucking bite.
I'm calling you out, my friend. You are scared of the girl from Texas. Well, I sure wouldn't be sitting there admiring the rippling, glistening fucking muscles of the fucking marsupial.
Oh my goodness.
Who in the world are you? Tolerant like that. Angry at life. Do your neighbors hear you? You must live in the forest for you to yell that loud.
The Monster Castle.
Have described it as not quite right.
Right. The wolf pack.
Oh my goodness.
Oh yeah.
I'm only over here because I heard your sweet fucking voice on the phone.
Oh, come on.
The head as a deacon, didn't you? You did too. We're going to go there. That's all I'll say thus far.
How about
we'll
we? How about?
Later.
I think that's a good
don't
one.
Don't answer.
If
don't
that's
answer
okay
now.
With Michael.
Wait
maybe we should
live,
wait until we're back on the
live.
Air. How about?
No, we're back. We are back on the air.
Oh.
Oh no.
Because it's just too good.
Shalom.
It's just too good. I put it back on.
Brother, Joe, right? Joe.
Yeah, Joseph. But you can call me Joe if you want.
Oh, Joseph. Yeah. So. Our little Baptist church potluck on Sunday, fried chicken, three different kinds, and egg salad sandwich, whatever they had, all the good stuff, chicken and dumplings, good time, bringing in the sheaves. I used to think they were saying bringing in the sheets, like bringing in the towels, bringing in the...
But pretty much.
But anyway, so our...
It's shepherding, that's what that was a reference to.
Great little old church, been, you know, going on for 50 years. And then that TV preaching got going on, that Paul and Jan, and they started clapping and hitting people over the head and
bonking people,
talking in tongues, blah, 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 blah. And that movement hit our church, our little old church, and it's like a cancer. It crept in to our church, and it just really, and our church went vacant.
They bonked people.
And now
they bonked people in the head.
Now those big Pentecostals, they're like big warehouse churches.
We'll be back in a second.
We destroy the government. We're destroying time. No more problems on the way. I'm through, doctor. We don't need your kind. We are the ones, ugly ones, stupid boys, wrong ones. I'm all alone, so are we all. We're all clones, all the one who murdered all the one who murdered all. Six is having problems, adjusting to its clone status.
Barking.
What happened?
Are we back live?
Yeah, what? We are.
How do you? Hey,
are we back on?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, so my point was him being Pentecostal and used to be Pentecostal.
Go ahead, Curtis. It was a good and had great question you had.
Oh, and he had to.
Let's let him answer.
Well, I didn't ask a question. I was just going to say real quick a wrap up, but then I'll ask. But did you have to? Yeah. Did you have to hit people over the head and slay them and make them shake on the ground as a deacon?
No.
Well, okay. Did that happen? No, other people did, right?
Okay. No, I didn't do that. I mentioned earlier I was a deacon of my father's Pentecostal church. Okay. Back in like around 1904, 1909 or something, I forgot exactly. The House of Azusa and Los Angeles, there's a movement, what we call the charismatic movement. That's the kind of the umbrella movement. From that, you get the Pentecostals, Assemblies of God, I believe, and other similar fundamental Christians of the charismatic nature. Some of them kind of dip into a little bit of the mysticism. Now, with my dad's church, because my parents came from Birmingham, Alabama, and they moved up here to Lincoln, Nebraska, and I was born here a year later. I've noticed, and what you're making reference to, Curtis, and some people may not know because a lot of people don't visit black churches who are not from that community. a lot of people, and maybe if you channel surf, you'll see this, or perhaps maybe you did visit a black church, and some white churches too, by the way, that are Pentecostal or other fundamentalists. You hear them, you know, as you're saying, Curtis, babble, you know, like hallelujah, you know, but hasha baba, you know, they're making some just phonetic noises that sounds like language. Now, that's from the book of Acts. I'm going to go around the Bible for you.
Some of
it. If you in the second chapter, you read the whole chapter. It's not that long. The day of Pentecost, the Holy Ghost was given. Jesus was sitting with the 12 disciples, and then they started speaking other languages. Now, here's the thing about it: if you read that carefully, they actually list the cultures, the countries, and I think Asia was even mentioned. It wasn't that they were just babbling. According to the book of Acts, they were actually speaking other languages. That's where the speaking in tongues reference came from.
The Tower of Babel was from
the Bible. You don't read that anymore. But somehow, and this I had to get some experts on this one. Somehow, a lot of denominations hooked on that, including my dad's church from the South, American South, in Birmingham, Alabama. And somehow they latched onto that one chapter, and then they focused the whole doctrine as a church around it. And so that's where you get all these people doing the babbling, as you call it, Curtis, because it's the book of Acts, and that's the day where God basically downloaded himself into the human beings instead of just the laws on some clay tablets in the Jewish faith. We're now uploading the faith of God himself into us. That's basically, and it was symbolism, supposedly.
Yes. Peter.
And you guys still there?
Yes.
You guys still there?
We're all clones, man. We're all clones.
You could be a preacher.
Okay, so I was getting a call and I had to hang up. I'm sorry.
Great stuff.
Keep going.
That's basically, Peter. It's called speaking in tongues amongst Pentecostals. Other people, they'll call it something else. But that's that's the gist of it, of why you hear a lot of fundamentalist Christians when they do that. And it basically started in Los Angeles in the early 1900s.
Yeah, and it's just like Babel. Like the word Babel actually goes back
to... Right, exactly.
Glacelia is what it's called.
To Babel, the Tower of Babel. And it's a lot of Babel.
Right, right.
Well, when Peter spoke to the crowd, I know what you're talking about in Acts 2. He spoke to the crowd. Now, Peter spoke his own language, but there were, I don't know all the languages, we would say today, there were German, there were Spanish, there were Vietnamese or Chinese, all out in the audience. And as Peter spoke his own language, they understood him in their language. That it was like right that moment that the Lord reversed the Tower of Babel there. Where everybody understood. Well, he didn't have to blah, 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 blah to them. He spoke his own language, Peter did. And they, with all the different languages in the audience, knew what he was saying. It was just a magical time.
It's not that simple, because I remember my late father, he was the pastor of the church. He actually, like you, Curtis, even as a Pentecostal pastor, my father didn't believe in that, which was surprising to me. You think he would. But to him, he saw it like, no, those are not real languages. They're just making gibberish and, frankly, raising money. That's how my late father used to see it. My mother, she disagreed with him. She's still around. She's still here. And she still sees it that, you know, a person can't go to heaven. At some point, you're going to have to speak in tongues as she sees it. You know?
Praying in the spirit, words between you and God. They call it praying in the blah, 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 blah. And it does that, but my praying in the spirit with my Lord, I'm one-on-one with my Lord, where I don't belong to any church, it's he and I personal, but what he's let me know, what praying in the spirit, where it's one-on-one with my Lord, is when I pray silently, I can pray like right now, I want to, 3, 2, 1, I just prayed to my Lord, you have no idea what I prayed in my mind, when you pray silently, when you're laying at night, asleep, and nobody, you try being silent for a while. All the bullies will come up to you and say, hey, what? I remember that. Praying, talking to your Lord in your spirit, just speaking your mind. He hear every word. You don't have to say a word out of your mouth for my Lord to communicate with you. That's praying in the spirit, not babbling, but one-on-one.
Well, of course, a lot of other Christians Satan, will disagree with you on
not
that.
Not even Satan. You know, but that's part of the problem
from my perspective as an atheist. I still remember when I was protesting with other fellow secular humanists, like 12 years ago, there's this one guy downtown Lincoln, Nebraska. He had, I'm not going to use the words, it was very derogatory towards the LGBT community. And we were protesting him because the church used to go to this particular place downtown. And he was talking to me. And then there's this one Catholic lady. He heard him talking to me. She heard him talking to me. And then she interjected herself. And she was saying, well, I, as a Catholic, disagree with you. And, you know, he was Protestant. And then they started arguing between each other. Okay, so, okay, and here I am, the atheist, looking at these two. They're both Christians, and they couldn't agree about – I forgot exactly what the issue was, but the point is this – and it was an important issue. It wasn't like a small issue like how many times you should have church. I mean, it was like one of those doctrinal questions. And it's not just Christians. All religions do this, okay? So I'm not picking on Christians. It's just this actually did happen, so I'm using Christianity because it really happened. So if a lot of people in whatever religion it is, you have the Sunnis versus the Shiites, you have the Protestants versus the Catholics, you have I can't think of the other ones right now, but it seems like all these different sects and different religions,
and they branch off,
and then one, like for instance within Christianity, a lot of Christians still don't see Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons as Christians. To me, as an atheist, they're still Christians. They make reference to Jesus Christ. Now they have a more recent history, Joseph Smith, you know, the 1800s and whatnot. So, but a lot of Christians don't even consider Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons Christian.
Yeah.
I mean, they can't even agree amongst themselves. But yet, you guys have the truth, and you're gonna get on me and us atheists and tell us we're wrong, we're going to hell, but you guys can't agree whether or not baptism is essential to eternal life. Some do, some don't.
That was seared in my mind all my childhood. Oh, the Mormons and the watch out all my life. Seared. They're going to die.
You guys want a baptism? You need a baptism? Who needs a baptism? It's Father Guido's here now.
Oh, Father Guido. Oh,
that's all right. How you doing? Yeah.
Are you going to baptize them? You did an alien. Okay?
We can't baptize anyone that needs a baptism. No, just thank you. Come on.
I didn't even baptize the Father Guido. No, thank you. I didn't want to drown anymore.
Get your head in there. Come on. Get it down in there. Stick your head in the water. Come on. You're baptized. Hey,
Careful,
Jesus Christ, man. Get in the water. Hey, I gotta pull on your skin like that and get you in there. Get in the water. Baptize. All right, that's it.
Father Guido, thank
you. Dunk all the
thank
way
you.
Under.
Now I believe.
You believe it now?
No.
You dunk all your body under.
You feel different, Joseph?
Baptist dunk all the way under.
I had to baptize.
Oh,
that is
seriously another issue. Am I
Methodist sprinkle?
Whether or not you immerse or you sprinkle. That's another major issue that Christians disagree on.
My mammy Thelma grandma, she said when it would start to sprinkle, hurry, get inside, you'll turn into a Methodist.
This
is an old time.
My wife
old
is a Methodist, by the way. I'm just saying. I don't know if she appreciates that or not, but she's gone.
That's
right
worth
now.
Fighting.
Anyway,
that's it. Now you're in trouble.
If you're going to get baptized, you want to go all the way under and, you know, wobble a little
so
bit under
how do you
water.
Guys feel about that? Well, you guys aren't really, like, hardcore Christians, so maybe you guys are the wrong crowd to ask. Maybe,
well, actually, Kurt is. Me, I'm just a spiritualist.
Okay.
I have my own beliefs.
Then always, anytime they get out of the water and the preacher bring them up, we sing up from the grave. He
actually,
rose.
You know what? What da, I want to ask you about is mind over matter. What do you think about mind over matter? About if I don't mind, you don't matter. It doesn't
what
matter.
Do like
if I don't mind, it doesn't matter.
Like...
No, actually, that works into it too. If I don't mind, it doesn't matter. But still, mind over matter. How
I was
you
baptized
can,
twice, so.
You know, you can actually manifest a thought. Your thoughts manifest, and what about thoughts having material weight?
I don't subscribe to that. But the closest thing to that, and it's scientifically proven, and this is actually from the medical field. Everyone's heard of this by now. Of course, I'm forgetting the word. They did placebo tests, and where they did tests where it's this sugar pill, and then there's the real medicine, and some people. They take the sugar pill, the fake, and they manifest the same. They think they're sick, so they exhibit symptoms that they're sick, but they're not really sick. But that's biological, and that makes sense. You would think, but that's not the same as what you're talking about. And I understand what you're saying, but my point, Michael, is that's the closest thing to mind over matter. And I was trying to remember the word I was trying to say. Of course, I forgot. But anyway, psychosomatic, that's the word I'm trying to say. It's known as psychosomatic.
Wow.
When you make yourself feel sick because you think about it, you worry about it so much.
Or you make yourself feel better.
No. I'm talking about physical manifestations.
That I'm aware of that we have, but otherwise, I personally do not subscribe to matter itself, or we manifest something just by thinking it. I've not seen any proof of it. I haven't read about it. I haven't seen it. I haven't experienced it. And therefore, I'm not going to believe it. Now, if someone's actually able to document this really happening, or if I run across it, then maybe I will see it that way. It's just I don't see any proof of it.
Okay.
That's all I'm saying.
I have seen proof of it.
I think deep down, you still believe in your Lord. I really do. Just way deep down.
I cannot think of any God.
I've never heard a better preacher than you.
I actually can't think of an example at the moment. So you got me dumbfounded, but I do have probably proof of that, what I was talking about. I just can't think of it right now off the top of my head. I don't know why. But yeah, mind over matter. Yeah, okay, I got one. Okay. How about electricity flowing from my fingertips? Like the Dark Lord from Star Wars. How did I do that? I had witnesses. I flew someone across the room.
Do we have such thing?
I threw someone across the room. I have witnesses. I melted the the wiring from the freezer all the way to the fuse box. Everything melted.
That's black magic, Mel. That's the opposite. That's the devil.
No, it isn't, Kurt.
I'm kidding, bro.
It's just electricity, and I felt like I was doing something scientific when I did it.
Jesus would not
tap it into the dark side.
Would not
actually felt like I was doing something scientifically when I did it. It was scientific.
You have a Ouija board, bro.
No, I first started by going across this carpet that had static in it. And it was one of those carpets that you could go across and with your feet and get static.
Yes.
But then I was able to feel the static going into my body and sit there and meditate and just pull static out of the air. And then charge myself so powerfully that you could see the electricity coming off my fingers.
Did you go down the hall up and down and just
No. I just sat there and meditated and I pulled it out of the air.
We did that as kids. We had the shaggy, burnt orange, full shag carpet, and as kids, we'd go around and then touch
static
you.
Electricity. Yeah,
I don't know what I was doing, but I did it.
Michael, that's getting close to altering the laws of physics. Like Curtis was too. But it sounds like that happens like a fraction of a second. What you're talking about sounds like it happened several seconds, and you had witnesses, and okay.
It was premeditated.
It was an experiment. Okay, all right. I'll have to take your word for it. I wasn't there, so I don't have an explanation for what you experienced. I personally have not experienced that, nor have I seen it.
Okay, we have a caller. Saying, caller, you're on the air.
That's anecdotal. You can never do... Anecdotes come in... There's a place for anecdotes to kind of put more meat on the bones of empirical data, and there's a time and all I have is your anecdote but I consider you a friend, so okay.
I don't know.
Maybe,
that's all I can think of right now. But I'll come up with something else. Mind over matter. I'll come up with other ones. That's the first one that came to my head. But I'm just trying to convince you that there is something else.
Well, I mean, you won't be able to convince me. no more than I'll be able to convince you to become an atheist. See, that's the thing about atheists. A lot of people, I remember when I sound just like you guys now, to be honest with you. Back in the 90s when I was in my 20s, there's this one, it was at a particular workplace, I won't say where it was. And there's this one lady, I had known her for a few months. She was new to the job. And we started talking one day, and it's like a few months later when she first started working. We were, I'd say, like a business-friendly relationship. We were able to acquaintances. But then she didn't say that she was an atheist, but she was like pagan, or she just was agnostic, or she didn't believe Jesus Christ is what it was. And back then I was a Christian, uber Christian back then. And I remember I was offended. It's like, I didn't say anything to her. I just kind of went quiet, and I never looked at her the same way. I feel bad about it now.
Zero.
But it's
one,
just interesting
three,
because I,
zero,
I was actually
three,
offended.
Zero.
Uh-oh.
Nine. One.
Sorry.
Three is not available.
No. Hang on a second.
I was actually offended that someone else didn't believe like me. I didn't do anything to her. I didn't curse her. Oh, obviously, I didn't curse her out as a Christian. Well, Pentecostal, I should say. Some Christians do curse quite a bit, quite frankly. But I just find it interesting, and looking back now, I can't believe that I had such a mindset that just because she didn't believe like I did, and we had just started working in the same place, and we were kind of like work friends, not, you know, we didn't hang out or anything, but then I didn't really want to talk to her after that, like I used to. I know that not all believers do that, but they're... My wife told me that years ago, there was this one uber Christian that she was friends with. We're talking like 20 years ago, about the same time period. And she basically stopped hanging with her. And she told my wife back then, just before we knew each other, but she told me about it. It's like that this particular Christian told her, well, you know, you could be a bad influence. We can't be friends anymore.
Yeah.
People are afraid to lose their faith.
If a person feels that vulnerable about their faith, A, you may want to check what you believe in. Apparently, it must not be that strong. B, perhaps your faith is not strong enough in your own faith.
Okay, I think we got a caller.
Trust me, I do not worry about people turning me.
Joseph, I think we have a caller.
Yeah,
caller?
I'm strong in being an atheist. I've been religious. I've been in faith. Religion, faith,
Joseph,
all the same to me. I don't care that...
Joseph, I think we have a caller. Caller, yes. You're on the air. Monster Castle Paranormal.
Hi, caller.
Hey, this is Joe. I had to come down out of my evil tower to talk to Joseph.
All right. Right on.
How you doing, Joseph?
Hi. Who is this again?
My name is Joe Root. My name is Joseph.
Joe, okay. Sorry, go ahead, please, Joe.
So you're on the show to talk about secular humanism, right?
That's one of the things, but that is what it's billed at. I didn't see it, but anyway, yes.
And so you believe that when your body dies, your consciousness blinks out, right? You're done.
Well, I don't believe it. It's that's how I see things. I don't see people raising from the dead to say, hey, it's real, guys. You know, that's just not happening, okay? So, I don't believe in the afterlife for good reasons. But, yes, go ahead. You want to make a point?
Well, you have never, have you ever, obviously you've never had any experiences of any of this then, right?
And I, quite honestly, to be honest with you, Joe, I don't think anyone has any of these experiences. I think a lot of people say they have.
Oh, my God. So you're calling me a liar? So you're calling me a liar then?
No. I was going to say some people are. I'm sure some people are. But I think also probably the greatest majority believe it. They actually believe what they, you know, and you can't, you know, c'est la vie. I don't care that they believe that, you know.
Boy, he's a talker.
Go ahead, Joe. I got to let you talk. Sorry.
Well, is your agenda to prove everyone wrong or to get everybody to leave each other alone?
Why would I have an agenda?
Everybody's got an agenda, brother.
To be honest with you, my agenda is to make exposure for my science fiction books
and my
paranormal books. That's my agenda, to be honest with you.
Okay. Yeah, we need to talk about
his
books.
I do radio shows like this. I've been doing this for years, Joe.
Right.
I've interviews. I have no agenda to turn anyone.
Okay, so your agenda is, like you were saying earlier, to just, hey, you leave me alone and I leave you alone, right? I mean, why enforce people's beliefs on anybody else? Separation of church and state.
That's the gist of what, last time I checked, I didn't notice any atheists passing laws trying to force people to be atheists. So it's not atheists you have to worry about doing that. That's Christians in the United States anyway.
I give you that. I don't think it's just Christians. I think there's other religions.
I said in the United States. I said in the United States.
But here's the thing, like, I've had my own experiences, right?
And okay, I'm listening.
I guess I could be perceived as a liar or somebody who's living a false reality.
I said some people, Joe.
Yeah, I know. But here's the thing. I agree with you that everybody should leave everybody alone. I hate religion to a certain extent, right? I know what it was designed for, and it backfired on society, right? It really did. But I think that what I want to ask you is how do we get past, because you're obviously an intelligent person, right? How do we get past everybody trying to be right and proving the other person wrong and evolve into a place where we can all just get along?
Oh, we got Ronnie now.
Excellent question, Joe.
I think we are getting along.
Excellent question.
I think we proved that we can do that.
Well, I appreciate you saying that. I don't like to use the word prove, but that's just me. That's just the agnosticism in me. Well, like I said, Joe, as an example, this is, again, anecdotal. My wife is a Methodist specifically, but she pointed out to me that she wanted me to tell people that she's Christian, born again. She uses the word born again Christian. So, okay. Mm-hmm. You know, when we first met, going on 8 years ago, we both divorcees, middle-agers, we met at a dance club here in Lincoln, Nebraska. And, you know, when you're middle-aged and divorced and when you're in the dating scene, you're like, you're too old for this shit. It's like, okay, this is what's going on. I'm an atheist, And she kind of did the same thing as a Christian. And it's like, okay, if you're open-minded to that, it's like, okay, and we see what happens. And, well, 8 years later, you know, we're married, you know, for 7.5 years of those 8. So now that, again, that's anecdotal. And I see where you're coming from, Joe. And I don't think we're, okay, I'm going to be honest with you, everyone. I am a pessimist by nature. I know it's popular for people to say that they're optimistic and all this other stuff. I am not. I personally look at what's going on in the world, and I already told you about how I felt, you know, disappointed in the human species, being as religious as we are with all the scientific advancements you know, we have all. But anyway, that's just one leg of it. Of course, obviously, what's going on with ISIS, Al Qaeda. You know, the Christian right and all. Yeah, we are. I'm not going to go on too much deep about it. It's like. Remember when I just told you a few minutes ago how I felt offended when that one lady at my job 20 years ago, when she said that she was not a Christian, and I didn't do anything to her. But my attitude changed toward her. I can't believe I was like that. Well, on a global level, that's what we have going on. We have a lot of people, specifically when they're atheists, but even when they're just of a different belief, even when they do believe things, we just can't seem to tolerate each other's fucking differences. Mm-hmm. And it's just irritating that, look, my wife and I are doing it. She's Christian, I'm an atheist. We didn't, and our marriage has never been on shaky grounds because of that. Now, mind you, some Christians think that other Christians should not marry outside the religion. That's okay. Their prerogative.
But hey, it's also the prerogative of those Christians. I got to jump in here. Okay. Joseph, it's bottom of the hour.
Yes.
I got to jump in here, buddy. My brother Rob is asking for your other Twitter handle. And he's an atheist, too. And he's listening to you right now.
You've got some new fans.
Yeah, buddy.
We also have Ronnie here.
What did you say, Darren?
Hey.
I said you have some new fans in Twitter, and Ronnie has joined the conversation.
Oh, yeah, and we're going to come back with Ronnie and Joe
real quick,
after this break.
Quick,
but we're having a break right now, folks. All right.
Oh, okay.
Dig
Sorry.
It.
Hold
and on, this Joseph. Is our last break before last half hour in the show, Monster Castle Paranormal Afternoon Radio. KTLK, The Fringe.fm.
dig it. Fantastic. It's your invitation to avoid the nauseation, frustration, desolation, mutilation, degradation.
It's final exam, like to rock, and that means Tuesday.
This is a donation station.
And I'll...
Yeah, baby. Go to MonsterCastleParanormal.com and donate today. Keep us rocking, man.
Okay.
Don't forget about Ronnie.
All right.
I'm hanging out with you.
Oh yeah, can you dig it? Monster Castle Paranormal Radio. And we're back. I believe Joe had a question, and we have Ronnie here. We have Ronnie. So maybe you could address Joe's question.
That was kind of the same one we had earlier.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, well, yeah, we addressed that earlier.
Okay. Was it a Ronnie or?
Well, okay, Ronnie's here now, so let's have Ronnie come on and ask a question then.
Hey, how's it going, man?
Not too bad. How about yourself?
Hey, I hear a lot about what you're saying there, and and I even joined the Zeitgeist movement. Have you ever heard of that?
The Zeitgeist movement?
Yeah.
I heard of it, but I don't know. Can you educate me on it?
Yeah, it's kind of a logical thinking movement, and they kind of put down religion, as being against the modern. We're a modern society, but we don't live like a modern society. In other words, it's ridiculous for all of us to have cars when if everybody wanted to drive it once, there wouldn't have been enough roads. So we waste so much of the Earth's resources duplicating stuff instead of sharing it, and the whole monetary system would just be thrown out in a Zeitgeist world.
I read about it, something like that. I don't know much, but I learned more about it from you. I have heard of it before. Okay, go ahead, please, Joe. What else did you want to say?
This is Ronnie.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry, Ronnie. Sorry, that was the other guy. Ronnie. Sorry, Ronnie. Thank you.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Ronnie. I'm sorry.
Basically, a lot of what the Zeitgeist movement is about is about, doing away with the monetary system and everybody being of service to each other and putting human beings above everything else, and instead of putting money above everything else and putting education. And they were talking about everybody could work a 20-hour week, and we could still accomplish the things that we have now. You could get everything that you have now, and you wouldn't have to pay any. You wouldn't have any bills. And the way something like that would start would be they'd have a big banquet, and all the richest people in the world would get trophies for winning at the human game, which is coming to an end. And the first thing they would do it with is get rid of the monetary system. And everybody would keep their job and then train other people. And they said, like, everybody could have everything they have now, work about 20 hours a week, and still live like they did. And there wouldn't be any starvation anywhere.
That's right. I agree with that.
Two words for you, Ronnie. Two words for you. Yeah. And why that? I agree with
Peter Joseph
that,
is the guy who started the movement.
I always thought of that too myself. That sounds so good.
Two words for you, real quick here, because I know we're kind of running up on end of the show real quick here. Two words for you in the United States, okay? Because you guys are coming out of Canada, Michael. Okay, utopia would be the worst most people will use for Ronnie. And secondly, can you say Bernie Sanders? When it comes down to like the work, kind of the work area, that's not quite how Bernie Sanders was talking about per se. But basically, this now you can get into the. I'm not going to go into the details at all about about the election and all this other stuff about Russia and Hillary Clinton did win the popular vote, but. Trump did win the Electoral College. That's a reality, okay? For whatever reason.
Yeah.
But this is my point. In the United States, we are not there, brother. We are far from there. People think right now that Bernie Sanders came through Lincoln, Nebraska. He went to what's called the Lead Center, and I went to go see him. I actually was for Hillary Clinton, still am. But
But anyway, the line was ridiculous. It was so long. Anyway, and the kids, it was almost like a religion the way they latched on to Bernie Sanders. And a lot of those people, a lot of people in the United States reject that notion. They think these kids are lazy. They think that we're not working hard enough, and this country, I guess certain portions in red states for sure. There are certain parts of the United States, they're just not for that, Ronnie. They will never be for that.
The rich people have the most to lose, you know, and they're the ones in the power. It would take a total crash to get there, I think. We'd have to rebuild from the ground up.
Well, you know what? There are alternatives, you know. I was for a time joined up with this movement, but I don't think it's realistic.
Okay.
It gets into like.
I gotta fill you in on Ronnie Joseph. I don't know if you've heard him before, but Ronnie's an experiencer of the paranormal and the strange. He has multiple experiences you could ask him about, including Bigfoot experiences, UFO experiences, goblin-like creatures entering his room while he's sleeping, and abduction, multiple family sightings, and all kinds of things.
I'd like to hook up with you on
social media. Look up Joseph Moore and follow me if you would please on Twitter. Joseph Moore, and if you can follow me, and Joseth and then Moore Moore on Twitter now, and please follow me and I'll follow you back, and we'll try to communicate that way. Okay, because we're hitting the show's almost done here.
Yeah, his stories are. You could always listen to when he was on our show. Those are some of our best shows.
Oh, okay. Awesome.
Do you want to talk about
that
your
way
books?
I can check his stuff out too.
Do you want to talk about your books before you leave?
Just real quick. And speaking of, I won't take that long. I just wanted to say what's interesting is remember when the United States a couple or a few weeks ago they were talking about banning electronic devices coming from other countries into the United States, and they're like, and the media, they're like, well, you better get your paperback novel ready because you can't bring your smartphones or your readers. And well, you know that, and also what I experienced today, and I was telling Wolfman Michael this, behind the scenes, my laptop actually crashed. I literally had zero space to operate my laptop, and I was thinking, you know, I have a lot of ebooks, a lot more than my paperback novels. And I was thinking, all these ebooks I'm writing, I do have four paperback novels, a couple of novellas, but what happens if for some reason, and this may run into what Ronnie's even talking about, what if, society crashes or something?
The Carrington event. Nothing, what if we have the Carrington event?
I would have
event.
Nothing to show for if all my books were ebooks. So I want to take, I have a collection, it's called E-Normal, 10 Paranormal Ebooks. Online, just look it up real quick. I'll let you guys look it up. Joseph Moore, Twitter. And I'm in the process. I already contacted a local publisher. I'm waiting to see if they've accepted it or not. I'm going to try to take my ebooks, and specifically I'm beginning with my paranormals. It's a collection of all my paranormal ebooks, and I'm going to have them published as paperback. Because seriously, I was thinking, well, if something happens in society in general, like what you're saying, Ronnie, or just, it'd be kind of nice for people to have that in their hands. I do have a few paperback novels already, but all my other stuff would be gone. So I'm going to try to publish all of my ebooks in paperback form. Not interested in hardcover, so paperback. And now I told you guys this last time I was on, real quick here. Tom Skerritt, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing his name correctly. He's an actor. He was in the first movie, Alien. He was at Alien Con in Silicon Valley when I was there back in October for the History Channel's Alien Con. And he had a talk, and I was there, and I asked him directly in front of everybody, how does someone get involved in getting their novels published, their novels turned into a movie? He suggested with the modern times, with the e-books and with the book industry not doing so well anymore, he suggested that I, go the route of like what they do at the Cannes Film Festival. So I'm thinking about trying to turn several, if not all, of my ebooks, and maybe even all my books, and possibly into movies or TVs. series. I've already talked to someone out of Los Angeles about it a few months
ago. That's groovy, man.
I tried this before a long time ago. It didn't work out.
So
we'll see. So that's what's new for me.
Hang on.
That's what I'm trying to do.
Joe there? Joe? Are you there? Uh-oh. Damn.
Well, that's cool. Hopefully he'll connect with me on Twitter, because I'd like to check his stuff out.
We had a call, and I'm just trying to patch it in. That's groovy. And you, as long as we got 14 minutes left, 15 minutes. So, long as you get your website out, and his books are awesome. I'd like to tell everyone his books are really cool.
Thank you.
Very,
thank you,
intellectually stimulating. Some of the ideas are just wild. Like even if you're just into, like feeling colors, you know, like you come up with that in your book. Well, it's actually something that we have people on. There's actually a name for it. People that feel colors.
What you said that you're, and when you what you said
it's 7:47, by the way. 7:47.
Oh, what?
Okay. Is Joe there? Joe, are you there?
Oh, sorry.
Did you call me back?
Yeah.
What's up?
Hey, you wanted you wanted another question for the guest?
No.
Damn. I thought you wanted to get back in here, Joe.
No. I just told him I'd ask my question for me, and I'd take it off the air about what he thought about hermeticism.
Oh, hermetics, or something? Is that what you said?
Yeah, and philosophy. Because honestly, I believe if the religions would evolve into a more philosophical thing, and if we only had, you know, philosophers and atheists, then, and I mean, true philosophers understood the symbolism of the myths and stuff. They didn't actually really believe in them. Some did, but most didn't. But
good
if we
point.
Just had
excellent point.
Philosophers and atheists, or scientists and philosophers, we wouldn't have none of this shit that's going on today in the world.
Well,
zero.
I do think we still would have I do, Joe. If I may, Joe, I do believe we still have conflict. I'm thinking of when I agree with you in the sense that it wouldn't be as bad. The reason, as an example, I'm thinking of the former Soviet Union. They were officially an atheist state, but of course, everybody knows the Russian church is very powerful in the Russian culture. Everybody knows this.
Okay, I want to ask something.
But officially, they were atheists, and look at the stuff that Joseph Stalin, some people say that he killed more than Hitler during World War II. I don't know if that's necessarily true or not. Something like 40 million people, supposedly. I don't know how true that those figures are. But the point is, I'm not quite sure if Joseph Stalin. Someone can correct me on this. I'm not sure if he was actually atheist or not. But the point is, it's an atheist state.
Okay.
And there still was problems.
Joe.
So it's not. Anytime you're dealing with human beings, you're going to have conflict.
Joe, I got to interrupt.
Yes.
Joe Roop.
Sure.
Who's coming on? Is there someone coming on at 7? Right. On the network.
Shift happens is going to replay. I don't think they're going to go live though, so it's a replay.
Okay,
but
if we want to,
why are you wanting to go into 7 o'clock?
Well, maybe. I'm thinking this is going on. This is going on. You know, we could keep going.
How long has the show been on so far?
Almost 3 hours.
5 o'clock Eastern.
Three hours.
Almost 3 hours.
Yeah,
now.
3 hours.
Yeah, we could cut it.
You might want to ask our guest first.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, no doubt.
That's true. First, you're on the air. I thought I'd ask you first because otherwise there's no point in asking the guest.
True. Welcome to podcasting, audience. This is real. This shit's real.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think, I promised the other host that I would play their replays
okay.
Just like I promised
I'll
you
shut
at
down
certain
in
time.
10.
So
I'll
I
shut
gotta
down
keep
in 10.
That.
Okay. All
no
right.
Problem.
We're shut down in 10. All right. It's been great, though, the discussions that just getting more and more powerful here. Anyways, I got the name.
Wait
a minute.
Michael,
it's called synesthesia.
So strong earlier.
Synesthesia is the term for someone who can feel colors. Now, I remember back in when I was a kid, it was more of a paranormal thing. But now they have a scientific name for people that can feel colors with their hands. And it's and
okay. I'm gonna have to research that, and then also the hermetics. I've heard it, but and the Zeitgeist. I have to research more of those. Those are three things I need to research more for myself.
Yeah,
hey, Joseph, I mean, you guys can keep going on Spreaker if you want. Yeah, you know, that's your it's your show, Wolfman. You know.
Yeah, I might just keep going on Spreaker. Everyone listening, I'll just go on to Spreaker after. If Joseph is willing, then we'll just keep on going.
Sure.
And I'll just reboot my. So if anyone's listening, all you have to do is just when it transitions from if you're in Eastern Standard Time, it'll be 8 o'clock. And just all you have to do is just reboot your page, like refresh your page.
Arizona 5 o'clock.
Yeah, it's in 10 minutes, so just refresh your page on Spreaker and you'll get us back.
I have a question for Joseph.
Yes, Darren.
When you're writing your fiction books, do you have God in your books? Do you like to explore the fantasy of a world with God?
You know, ironically, I hardly ever write about that, but a couple of times I have. The first I'm trying to do a better job being succinct, so I'm trying to think how I should say it. Okay, 2005, my second novel came out. It's called, I already mentioned it earlier today, it's called The Solar Bridge, The Unintended Consequences of Time Travel, yada yada. The Dr. Patrick McLean, the protagonist of this novel, time traveling novel, he's actually agnostic. Basically, I interjected my agnosticism at that time.
Zero.
It was before
one,
I became a full
three. Zero, three, zero, uh-oh. Nine,
I
one,
I can't
three
stop this.
Is not available.
Okay, I got it.
So that's probably the most I've ever interjected anything about religion. The other times it's just, I mean, maybe in passing, like in one sentence. But remember, as an atheist, I don't wake up thinking about, let's see, what is it that Christians and Muslims and Jews and Buddhists, what is it that they're thinking of? I don't pray. It's just, I mean, religion or faith, spirituality, whatever you want to call it, it's just not a central part of my existence. So I don't walk around thinking about what
books.
Religious people or spiritual people think. But I have touched upon it. But you know, I'm writing from I'm not even writing from the viewpoint as an atheist, to be honest with you, Darren. I'm just writing characters about situations they're in and.
Yeah.
Every now and then something was like, oh, maybe it'd be a good idea to put in something about religion here. And that's about it. I hardly even talk about it.
Yeah. Well, I want to read one of your books. How long are most of them?
Thank you.
You said novellas?
I would suggest you try my ebooks first, if you don't mind.
Okay.
You can go to smashwords.com, or you can go to Ink It. That's a little bit more. This Ink It is I-N, like ink. I-N-K, but it has, and then it, but it's spelled with two T's. So ink it
okay.
with two T's and then .com. That's a better format, actually. It's more of a single scroll and beautiful pictures and stuff. But yeah,
cool.
I suggest ebooks, just sample. Most of them are free.
Wow. Okay.
And I appreciate you saying that, Darren.
And you can order, you have four books too that are in paperback?
Yes, I do. I do. Actually, two of them are full-fledged novel. I told you about the time traveling one, and then Astropia, which is a book. It's called the Lunar Series. I have three books. The first one is Lunar Legends, and you can see it at Amazon.com. Go to Amazon.com, put in Joseph Moore, you'll see it. Lunar
okay.
Legends is first. Astropia is book two of the Lunar Series, and then the one that came out last year is called Visitors.
We
Survival.
Got 5 minutes left.
That's
We got yeah. 5 minutes left.
In other words,
folks.
Ronnie?
No, wait a minute. Ronnie's still there. Ronnie, do you have any more questions for the
oh,
guest?
Oh, I didn't know he was still
five
there.
5 minutes left.
No, I'm listening to what he has to say. I'm very interested. You know, I was an atheist for years, and I wasn't as near a nice atheist as he is. It used to piss me off just to drive by the church.
Oh, wow.
But you know, I believe in God now, And
wow, that's different.
The way I came to believe in God was I challenged God to show me that he exists.
Yeah.
And I boldly challenged him, and he boldly showed me.
How did he do that?
It's interesting. Your premise is to...
I want to hear how he did it.
A, you assume that there was a God to even talk to.
Okay, 47.
That shows that you had a bias towards the monotheistic belief that most Christians, you know...
I want to hear it.
I'm just saying it's telling.
I want to hear it, Ronnie.
I would like to challenge, if any, God.
Okay, I want to hear what Ronnie... We have 5 minutes left. Let's hear what Ronnie has to say. What made him change?
Okay.
Well, you know, they asked me if I'd ever look for God, and I was in an alcohol rehab center, and I was trying to get well. And I told them, hell no, I don't believe in God. And they said, well, have you ever looked? Have you ever tried to make contact with God? You know, and they were talking about, you know, how wrong that was for me just to pronounce to the world it wasn't a God, even though I never took the time to look. And so we were doing what they call a third-step prayer upon this hill. And I said, ask God, I said, if you're real, I need you to let me know. And this dove flew out of the trees and flew right above my head and landed on a cross above my head. And then
so what do you mean a cross?
I wasn't willing to admit, because my mind was like, well, there's birds everywhere out here. You know, it's probably just random happening. And then I said, God, if that bird was really your sign, I need you to give me another sign. And believe it or not, he pooped on my shoulder.
That is awesome. I remember when I was about
and I stood up, a bird pooped and on I stood my up face. And I looked up at the clouds. Does that mean thunder God rolled exists? Across the sky.
Wow, that's weird.
Ronnie, did you? I don't know if you heard that, wow. Ronnie. I had a bird poop on my face when I was like 5 years old, when I was walking. Does that mean God exists? Because a bird just happened to poop on my face.
Yes, that's you should if take you that and run with it. Yeah.
If there was a God, maybe.
I agree. You got to ask God.
It had to be.
God, you know, God made our bodies to poop.
For you to share that with us, just
God made our bodies to poop. He did.
All the earth knows. Goddess,
the great.
I challenge God. I said, show me. You know, prove to me. Prove to me you exist. And he did.
Oh, how and, about all know, these sigils and, that we use? Know, like, I don't understand. Why do they work?
For me to believe, that's what it took.
Why does it all work? Right? Why do the magic symbols work? Why does all the magic symbols work, Joseph? Why do they work? Why do they work for me?
Well, they don't work. Not I haven't seen them work. I you know.
Joe, I do they work for you?
But I just find it interesting, Ronnie. If I can,
I
real quick.
What you're talking about, Wolfman.
Did you try to see if other gods exist, Ronnie?
Okay, say it again.
We don't know what you're talking about.
Did you challenge the other gods? Did you try to see? Like there are various pagan gods, both in Europe and Africa, and there are other notions of gods besides the monotheistic version of the Judeo-Christian. Yeah. Did you try to challenge those other gods?
But yeah, you know,
that other people.
Hey, you know, I leave that open to God. You know, I just know that he's God and I'm Ronnie, and he can be whatever the hell he wants.
All right,
and I can be whatever.
We can do whatever we want.
I know it may not be a religion, but...
We are gods. Have you guys watched the show Legion yet? Legion. You check it out.
And it's got me by so far.
Yeah, Legion, man. That's a cool show, man.
You really like it?
Legion is real, man. That shit is real.
There are cameras behind
that. You're talking about the one in the diner, right? With the angel?
No, Legion is it's a Marvel... thing. It's on, I think, FX channel.
Oh, you mean, the series.
Yeah, it's a series, and it's a series about psychics that can actually change reality.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
I used to think Bionic Man and Bionic Woman were real, too.
You guys never had it happen to you yet, where you phase out and then pop in and you're in a different spot. You're not where you were before. The last thing you remember was 2 hours ago.
Kind of like beam me up, Scotty, like they did in Star Trek.
This is gonna happen to
that
you.
Way.
One day, maybe, you'll be unlucky enough to have it happen to you. And it's not fun, let me tell you.
I gotta go get cigarettes. I'll be back. Cigarettes.